There's no such thing as Bigfoot. Well, that's what I used to think. I know better now. The date was August 13th, 2014. The location was the top end of the Toledo Bend Reservoir, a lake that's 65 miles long and 10 miles wide, located in North Louisiana, about 15 miles out of Logansport, Louisiana, off of State Highway 420. It's near an area known as the Grapevine. Now, this place is very isolated woods and marshland. Access can only be done reasonably by boat. I had with me Tony and Carl, the twins. We were out in the boat trying to catch some bream on their beds. We were easing along the marshy east bank of the lake. That's the border between Louisiana and Texas. We were running the trolling motor, throwing crickets, and looking for fish. I noticed what I initially thought was the back of a wild boar messing around in the edge of the water. It was way too big to be a sow. I pointed it out to the boys. Of course, they wanted to get closer and have a look. I kind of wanted to myself. We have lots of wild pigs in the area, but I thought this one looked to be a monster. How true that statement turned out to be. I couldn't get all the way to the bank in the boat. The water was just too shallow. But Tony and Carl, they're special needs boys, and we try to get them into everything they are interested in. So I got us within maybe 10 feet of the bank, and we tied up and we jumped into the edge of the water. I had grabbed my Kel-Tec 22 mag and strapped it on my hip before we got out of the boat. We were maybe 60 yards away from the hog. I told the boys to walk on some marsh grass and to be quiet. We had cut the distance to about in half when I looked at the critter, and I was very surprised when I noticed that it looked like it had arms. Oh, crap! I grabbed the boys by the arm and put my finger up to my lips. As I watched it, it would swing its arms slowly back and forth in the shallow backwater. Then I saw what it was paying such close attention to. There were some carp that had been trapped in this shallow slough when we had a flood about a month earlier following a hurricane. As the water receded, they couldn't get out of the swampy puddle. Their dorsal fins and backs were visible from time to time. We watched this for maybe 5 minutes, long enough that Carl had gotten his phone out and was playing some Thug Life video game on it. And of course the camera lens was broken on this rowdy kid's phone, so there's that. Tony was as transfixed on the critter as I was. Twice it made lunges with its arms trying to catch a fish. They were able to thrash and wiggle away from his grabs. His luck was about like ours. No fish. When he grabbed at the fish, he would make an exhaling, grunting kind of noise. It was deep and raspy. Its hair was black, but not shiny like a dog. Hard to describe its color. It looked like kind of a sun-faded black with ginger tints in it. Its hair was long and shaggy, but dull-colored. Its face had no hair on it. Its hands were very big, and I saw that its thumbs were smaller than ours are, and came out from the base of his fingers, and was higher up on the palms than a human's. It was big, but not really as bulky as I had imagined in my mind a Bigfoot would be. I'm a big man, 250 pounds or so, and it was much thicker and wider at the shoulders than I am. Several times it cupped a hand and dipped into the water and drank deeply. Then, I guess at that point, Carl reached another level on his game, and his phone made a ta-dum kind of noise. I was looking at the thing, and when that noise sounded, its whole demeanor changed. Its body language changed. It got stiff, and it began slowly turning its head, trying to find the source of the noise. Its eyes were brown, and to me, they were a little beady-looking. Under a protruding forehead, the nose was flat against its face with huge nostrils. I could see those nostrils. They were working like a dog's, trying to figure out that disturbance. Its mouth was a little too big for its face, I thought. When it was drinking, it must have somehow gotten some grass or weeds into its mouth, because it was trying to work those out with its tongue, which was exceptionally long, maybe twice as long as a man's, and contorting its mouth. I also saw its teeth. They were like a dog's teeth, with the front teeth being similar to ours, and it had very pronounced canine teeth. I hadn't considered the wind when starting this little pig adventure, because I figured we would wind up scaring it away anyway. I wasn't worried about a hog charging us. We were in the water, and I knew that it would run for the woods if startled, not into the lake. The wind, if there was any, was into our face, and we were downwind. Its gaze never got around far enough to see us, but it was uneasy, and now so was I. If my baby Heather knew where we were, she wouldn't be her usual smiling self. I think if she had had a chance, she'd have been out there with us. She has made the boys adventurous, and they are pretty fearless, which ain't always good. A little of her has rubbed off on me, I guess, but sometimes discretion is the greater part of valor. These boys were in my care, and I had the .22 mag in my hand by now. But this thing, it was way too big and too thick for that little pistol to do anything but make it mad. Honestly, shooting it never crossed my mind other than for defense. I estimated the weight to be between 300 and 400 pounds. I knew I wanted to get the boys back and away, but thought that it might be smarter to wait it out. So we watched it quietly. Well, two of us watched. I had taken Carl's phone and switched it to silent mode and handed it back to him, and he continued being a gangster on his phone, absolutely oblivious to our situation. We were probably 30 yards away from the boat, and I knew we couldn't get back in the boat in the water and mud before it caught us if it wanted to. After a couple minutes, it went back to fishing and turned its back to us, bending over. It was a male. I know that for sure. No doubt. Quite the display. Tony dropped his little toy that he carried everywhere, and it made a small splash. It was loud enough for the beast to hear. He again got very alert trying to find the intruders. I don't know if he winded us or if he just got nervous, but he began slowly moving away. He walked on two legs like a man with a little bend in his back, and he was grabbing the marsh grass and tree limbs as he walked. He was in muddy, slippery mud and marsh grass, so I think he was using his hands to steady himself, which was a natural thing to do. This was the first time he had stood up to full height, and he was big, but he moved quite fluidly, like the wild animal that he was. He had to go under a tree that had fallen against another, and then he had to bend down slightly to get under it. He moved deliberately, not like an animal that's afraid. He moved like an alpha animal that did not fear much of anything. His stride was long, and his pace was good. He moved silently, and he just disappeared from sight without making a sound. Before he got out of sight, he turned and looked in our direction. His gaze lingered. I think he knew we were there, and he was looking right at us. Just before he stepped out of sight, he stood upright, and I know he was looking at us then, because he started a roaring noise. It was a long, dry, raspy-sounding, high-pitched moaning sound, ending by grunting over and over, much like a bull elk bugling. And then he was gone. After a few minutes, we walked down to where he had been fishing, looking for evidence or tracks. There were some large smears in the mud, but nothing that I would call a track. I went to where he had ducked under that tree, and I could walk under it standing straight up, and I'm 6'2". This Bigfoot is between 6'8" and 7 feet tall. We got back in the boat and decided we had had enough for one day. I was relieved to be back in the boat. He had never seemed aggressive, and I don't think he would have harmed us, but I would never chance it with those two with me. Okay, I wouldn't have chanced it, even if I'd had a high-powered rifle in hand. But I don't think that any of us had malice in our hearts. We hadn't been home 10 minutes before I heard the boys telling Heather about the big hairy man that we saw. I could hear her infectious laugh as she excitedly encouraged them to tell her all about it. They wanted to call Cousin Dean and tell him all about it. She laughed and told them, "Go ahead, call him." Later, when Heather and I were in bed, I tried to tell her what had happened. I'm so thankful to have a woman who has such an open, positive mind. I hit the jackpot on that one. She had no trouble accepting it, but we decided that we wouldn't make a big deal of it to our friends. The boys did tell Dean about it, and he quit working on his science project of the solar system after he had made all the different flat circles out of styrofoam representing the planets and the sun. He decided to research it and wound up making his project all about Bigfoot instead. I still occasionally get out in that area looking and listening for something to confirm what we witnessed that day. So far, no luck. I will never forget the images in my head of this creature, and that roar makes the hair on the back of my neck stand up thinking about it. I can only hope to hear this sound again, because there will be no mistaking it. So this is my Bigfoot experience. I am smarter than I used to be. Not a lot, but now I know one thing without a doubt. There is such a thing as Bigfoot. I know it. Feel free to tell my story. I feel like I'm getting a weight off my shoulders telling it to somebody outside of the family. Use my first name if you want, Kenny. But with the small town culture being what it is, I'd rather not have my last name published. I'm a professional man and rather would not be labeled a kook locally. Thanks a lot, Kenny. First Nance, thanks for being out there. I thank you for allowing snackage, Oreos, chips with sour cream, and homemade fudge. I usually listen to you after 9 p.m. with the lights out and a candle lit, like an indoor campfire. I sometimes fall asleep listening, just like bedtime stories from Mom. That said and done, I would title my story, If I Knew Then What I Know Now. I ask, for the sake of the big feet involved, not to disclose where this happened, though the people who have been there will probably figure out where I was. And just as a side note from me, folks, this did happen in the state of Ohio in one of the more major cities at one of the parks, and that's as close as we're going to get. The year was 2012, and I was homeless, and I was staying in a very large city park that boasts a casting pond for catch and release, picnicking, and had two open shelter houses. The one I was sleeping in was without picnic tables, and it was very close to the casting pond. It had a big fireplace. There was a wall that went up about 3 feet around most of the building. The rest of the building was open, and yes, it was cold, as this happened in November, because I was there on Thanksgiving Day. I would gather my wood for the fireplace during the day, and I would store it in the shelter. It never got bothered, except by some young Islamic men who would burn my firewood just to toast some hot dogs. But they would leave me the all-beef hot dogs, the buns, and some roasted chicken in exchange for using my firewood. One of the ways to break smaller pieces of wood from branches was to whack it against a tree. Did someone say tree knocks? Well, if I knew then what I know now. Except for weekends and early morning dog walkers, the park is pretty well empty. I'm pretty sure the cops knew I was sleeping there, as I would see in the dark the car pull up into the parking lot on their rounds, and they could see me sit up. But I wasn't the drinking type, and they left me alone. In fact, There was more than one night where I heard a car come into the parking lot, and I could see enough to note that it was missing the lights on top. I would sit up, and then I would watch the people speed away, thereby preventing a party at the shelter house. One night, I heard a loud splash in the duck pond water. I didn't have a flashlight, and the only light came from the parking lot, which was maybe a half a block away from the pond. I figured it must be a stray dog. So I get up, and I leave the shelter house, and I walk over to the casting pond. I can't see what is in the water, only that it is about maybe 4 feet long, at least. I started talking to it, saying things like, "Well, I can't tell what you are, but obviously you are not a dog, because you keep chattering at me." On one of your shows, you mentioned the word geckering, and I went to the supporting website, and there was my chattering noise. I thought at the time maybe it was a beaver, because my mom had told me that a beaver colony had been set up nearby. If you walk about a half to three-quarters of the way west from the shelter house, you are at the river, and most of the river has trees and wooded areas. The park is big. It has tennis courts and a rec center, a library, big enclosed shelter house, and 2 to 3 acres of nothing but beautiful flowers. Yes, people even get married there. But I digress. Okay, I got an unidentified animal, 3 to 4 feet long, swimming around chattering at me. If I knew then what I know now. It's cold, and I'm barefooted, so I figured, okay, it's got to be a very large beaver. If it's a beaver, I've got carrots and celery sticks given to me by a Christian outreach service. I can't eat them because I had no dentures, so I gifted the beaver, or whatever it was. I leave the food next to the side of the pond. Maybe in the morning it will still be there, and I'll see what it is. I go back into the shelter house, and I go to sleep. In the morning, whatever it was is gone, but so are the carrot and celery sticks. What now appears near the place where I left the gift of food is a piece of wood that has been chewed by a beaver. It was not there the night before. I find a tree that looks like it was chewed by a beaver, about 10 to 12 feet away in the brush. You can't see it from the sidewalk that goes around the pond. You have to go trudging through the then knee-high weeds. All I know is that I had a large chattering animal in my pond. I left food for it, and in the morning I have a gift of a piece of a firewood that would have had to have been transferred from the brush and dead weeds into the open. Okay, so maybe I have a helpful beaver? I mean, hey, Cinderella got help, right? I start thinking, maybe it wasn't a beaver. Maybe it was a selkie or something. Selkies are found in Celtic lore, humans that turn into seals and use wood for food. I didn't know then that Bigfoot left gifts of food. The next night, my mystery swimmer was back, chattering away. I cursed the fact that I had no flashlight, and I told my chattering friend, "No, I can't go swimming with you. It's too cold." I left the last of the celery and carrots. In the morning, no gift of firewood, just a few rocks nearby. Yes, if I knew then what I know now. Now, this sounds like Bigfoot activity, and probably a young one. 8 years later is when I put together what I know now. Because in another part of those woods, there was also one of those teepee structures. And I feel bad about the teepee. I had asked another hobo about the structure, and he said that a man claimed he built it. I tried to dismantle it. I was somehow pissed off that some human, which I had been incorrectly told, had built it. It might have been why my swimming, chattering friend never came back for another night swim. If I had known now what I didn't know then. Now I've wondered in the last years, why was I befriended? possibly because of similar things. One, that I didn't get the chance to bathe, so I smelled like what God, I hate to say, meant us to smell like, until someone overvoted him and soap was invented. For another, even in that cold November weather, when nature called, I was off to the area right next to the shelter, shoeless. Plus, I do something they do especially when I go to urinate. I peep over that 3-foot wall to check for incoming cars. And if you were a Bigfoot, you could tell that I was leery of other people. That makes me more on their side than the rest of the human race. By the month of December, thanks to a family who befriended me, the governor of Ohio pushed to get my disability okayed. It had been turned down 3 times before. Now, with an income, I could get some housing. It wasn't right away, and what happened is going to be in a book that I'm going to write. I wish I'd had a flashlight, and I'm sorry I dismantled part of the teepee-like structure. Like I said, if I had have known then what I know now. Thanks. I hope you can use this. Squatch on. Signed, Jacqueline. Nance, I've heard your call out there that you wanted to hear from anyone if they've been sassed by a squatch, gotten a royal escort out of the forest by the king himself, and all those other things you say. Well, I got something worse than sassed. And my escort out of the forest? Well, I didn't even get out of the forest. I still don't know what to make of it. Maybe you and the SAS squad can help me make something out of all of it. I am an avid hiker. 2018, I was in the Garden of the Gods in Illinois. I was trying to recover from some personally devastating things that occurred to me that summer. So I stayed out all summer as much as I could. At that time, I was camping in the area, and I was trying to hike different trails daily, and I liked to go off trail. I had already hiked all of the known marked trails and decided that day to start going off trail. I preferred being off trail most places that I went if I could. Moving on. From different points along the observation trail and other trails, I had seen more rock crests and ridgelines further out that were not on any marked trails. I pondered, what kind of views would I have from them? That the views were worth it was confirmed to me from talking by chance to another hiker in the area. So, that afternoon, I headed west in search of those rock crests. The terrain that day that I was going through was both light and challenging, but I made it to the crest just fine. I rested there for about a half an hour, and with my field glasses, I could see the tourists out on the more popular rock crop about a half mile away on observation loop. I rested for a little while longer, took in the views that made it all worth the while, and then I reversed my steps to go back. I started back, and it was just after 4 p.m. that day. It's August. It's hot, clear, and the visibility was high. I was threading through some scrubby-looking cedars and other trees when I became sure that I was hearing footfalls somewhere behind and to my left. I stopped and I scanned the area behind me. The vegetation was all leafed out. Of course, it was August. But the scrubby cedars, they left big gaps here and there throughout my sight of view, I think because nothing wants to grow next to them. I looked, but there was nothing to see. So I shrugged it off as some kind of wildlife, and I didn't worry any more. But, as I went on, I could clearly hear that something was walking nearby. Each time, I would stop abruptly. I would turn. But it had stopped, too. That's when I thought maybe it wasn't wildlife. Now, it wasn't unheard of in the hiking world that sometimes people will catch you out there alone. And usually, they'll just rob you for what you have. But I didn't even have $100 on me. I had just enough after paying my campsite fees to put gas in my Jeep and then head home when I was done, and maybe enough left over to get a burger on the way. But being a woman, there are worse things than robbery that can happen to you out in the wilds. But I was also armed. I had a Glock 19 that had been a gift from my mother, who was always worried about me out there traipsing alone, as she called it. I stopped, and I turned in the direction that I had last heard any movement. I pulled the Glock out of my leg holster. I made sure that it was up, ready and visible, and I chambered around slowly and deliberately, letting the noise carry in that direction. I waited a second longer than I needed to, and then I deliberately turned and began moving out of the area. To my surprise, the sound followed. Now I was getting a little worried. I've only ever had to brandish my gun one other time while out in the wilderness alone, and it did the trick immediately. Both of the men that thought they were being slick and trying to ease into my camp at night hightailed it out of there as soon as they heard me chamber around. So yeah, I was now a little worried, because whoever was following me wasn't worried that I had a gun. The walking sounds always seemed to remain the same distance at that point, so I reasoned at least they weren't getting closer to me. But the whole time I'm walking, I'm wondering, what do they want? What are they after? I'm now really worried, and I'm slowly starting to pick up my speed, and I noticed so are they. I tried several times to stop and whirl around to get a sight of them, but every time there was nothing to see. I'm really worried now, and I'm a good runner, so I start with a light jog. I figured, I'm used to running. Maybe they aren't. I can probably outdistance them, and my stamina is incredible. But that was the wrong move, because now I'm seeing things flying around me, above me, and in front of me. Sticks, rocks, all kinds of things. I couldn't make sense of it. So now I picked up speed more, and I'm in a full dead run. But when I did that, the stuff started flying faster. That's when I heard a deep lung bellowing sound. It wasn't a scream or a yell. It was like a deep chest rumble, but it was definitely an intentional sound that was being made in my direction. That scared the bejesus out of me, I don't mind saying. I have heard all kinds of animals on my hikes over the years. I've heard bears, I've heard elk, I've heard everything you can imagine. Mountain cats screaming, but I have never heard anything anywhere like this. Then my hair stood up on end even further when that sound started again fresh, but now it sounded like it was winding up to a higher pitch, and it was now coming out like a full screech, and it sounded much closer to me. Before I could turn around, the next thing I knew, I remember seeing the dirt, and that's all. When I came to, it was much later. I could tell by the light in the shadows around me. I'm trying to push myself up from the dirt. I'm confused, but I'm also in pain like you wouldn't believe. It hurt to breathe. I had to search around to find my gun. It was my first thought, believe it or not, even in my pain. It was a few feet out in front of me, like it had been knocked from my hands. As I'm reaching around for my gun, I look at my watch. It said it was almost 7 p.m. Where had the time gone? What had happened? In my head, I figured out I had just enough light to get back to where I needed to be. It was painful and slow, but I made it back to the camping area. I spent a miserable night in my tent with absolutely no sleep and a lot of pain, and yes, not a small amount of fear. One of the other campers there that I had been talking to previously that day was a woman and her husband. When I got back to camp, they knew I wasn't okay. They asked me what happened. I said that I had taken a bad fall and I was hurting something bad. I told them that my back was really sore. The woman asked if she could look at it for me, and I let her. She told me that there was a big line of bruising across the middle of my back, wrapping around to one side. It made sense because that's where I was in incredible pain. I managed to make it through that night, and in the morning, her husband worriedly helped pack up everything. Well, in truth, he did pack up everything on his own. I really couldn't do much. He put it all in my Jeep, and I drove to Harrisburg, and I got checked out there. Turns out, I had 2 cracked ribs. I am still not sure, Nance, exactly what happened. I believe to this day that it was a Sasquatch or a Bigfoot, whatever. Because when I came to, nothing had been taken, so it wasn't robbery. And I sure hadn't been assaulted in other ways. To be blunt, I was on my period, and all the quote-unquote gear for it, shall we say, had been undisturbed. So it was definitely not any kind of an assault of that type. Looking back, Nance, I think my mistake was picking up speed. Because that's when things started happening. And then, when I went into a full run, I think I triggered that instinct of prey drive in the Sasquatch or whoever it was. And instead of just throwing a tree branch or a rock at me, it was close enough to hit me. And it hit me good. And that's how I ended up face down. And that's how the gun got knocked out of my hand. And that is how I had cracked ribs. I can't even tell you that I saw what it was. Thinking back, I wonder if there might have been more than one of them. I never smelled anything, and I was too disoriented when I came to look for prints or anything around me. Plus, it would have done no good. The light was fading. I wasn't thinking about anything but getting out of there. I certainly wasn't thinking about a Sasquatch. At that moment when I came to, I was still scared and thinking that some human had attacked me, and maybe they were still in the area. None of it made sense. It doesn't now any more than it did then. It's been just over 2 years, and the more I think about it, the more I've read and the more I've seen and heard, the more I am convinced that it was a Sasquatch that attacked me. I think it was probably a young one, and if I had to guess from what I know of the wild, it was probably a female not happy that I was in her territory. I wonder, because I was on my period. You know, you do have to wonder, don't you? I do still hike, but I don't go off trail by myself as much anymore. Nance, what I have told you right here is 100% true as it actually happened to me. I turned around several times right before whatever it was knocked me out, and I tell you there was nothing there. I've heard your other story that talked about them maybe being camouflaged. I've heard others say that maybe they can go invisible, or maybe their fur helps hide them from view. I don't know. All I know is I did turn around several times in the several minutes before something knocked me out. I had clear fields of view between the trees all around me, and I am telling you there was nothing and no one there. Nothing was close enough that it could have hit me hard enough to knock me out. Well, nothing that I could see, anyway. I also believe that if it had been a human, they would have robbed me, or worse. I mean, why else bother to follow and attack me? I don't know, Nance. I just go over and over it. And 2 years later, I still don't have an answer. Only one thing fits, that I got sassed by a Squatch in the worst possible way. You can sign me Sassed and Outclassed in the Wilds by a Squatch. Hi, Nance. I've been listening to your channel for a few months and love it. I decided to share now because I listened to Marathon Episode 13 and there was a story from Tomahawk, Kentucky. I have had 3 experiences within 5 or 6 miles of there. In 2005, I had moved back to the area and was clear-cutting over the gas lines that run through the hills. It was still muddy from recent heavy rains, and we were almost to the bottom, near an ATV trail. and that's when I noticed weird impressions in the drying mud. I walked over, and I stepped in one, noticing that they were over 2 feet deep and big enough to put both feet in. When I got to the bottom, me and a coworker looked up and were like, "Those are footsteps." The next one happened in September 1988. I was 14 and outside. I heard the most blood-curdling screaming I've ever heard. Kind of sounded like a woman, but definitely not a woman, I thought. It literally made the hair on my neck stand up. It was coming from the top of the ridge behind my house and at a volume that I'd never heard any living thing reach. It lasted for a few minutes and stopped. Over the next week or so, this happened almost every evening around sunset. My first experience was in early August 1984. In the previous 20 or so years, a lot of strip mining went on in this area. In one of those places, they had built up a dam and made a beautiful little pond in the middle of nowhere. We called it the Blue Lagoon, I'm assuming because of the movie. That summer, part of Route 645 was being built, and it gave us a way to get there in about 10 minutes. With Mom's car, we had to park about 80 yards from the pond and then walk up the old haul road that came up to the left side of it, and we made a 90-degree turn and then dead-ended at a rock face, which we used for a diving platform. It was getting to be sunset, and everyone was leaving. Being 10 years old, I was dragging my feet when my mom told me and my sister to get our butts out of there. By this time, my mom was putting stuff in the car and getting irritated. She raised her voice, and we knew to get going. Now, just before my sister made the turn to go, I remember her saying, "Ew, something is stinky." I smelled it too, and it smelled like old wet dog smell or some kind of soured carpet. It was just stomach turning. Then I saw something move from the corner of my eye, right behind a huge pine about 30 feet away. I froze, because whatever it was huge, and it stopped moving. I could make out that it was auburn-colored, and all I could think of, that big, was a brown bear and how it was hidden so good. After what seemed like minutes, I can hear my mom getting more irritated. "Stop messing around and let's go." But being a curious 10-year-old, I had to know what it was. I was about 10 feet from the corner, and I took off at a dead run, rounded the corner, and went out about another 10 feet or so, and then spun around to a dead stop. That's when I saw it standing to the left of the tree, and that I had startled it. It quickly shifted to the other side of the tree into a squatting position. I got a quick peek of the hip and elbow, and then the eyes. This thing had to be 8 feet tall, and at least 3 at the shoulders. It really confused me at the time, thinking, how much a bear looks human? But that thought went quickly, as I was scared. I ran towards the car and almost immediately heard it almost right beside me in the brush, and I started screaming hysterically for my mom to get in the car. She could hear the dry brush snapping and said, "Maybe it's a bobcat." By the time she got in the car, I was nearly sick. I thought they weren't real because of what adults had told me, and I struggled with what it was. As I got older, and I started hearing experience after experience, I'm positive what it was. There aren't any brown bear in that area, and I haven't ever seen one try to hide. This thing didn't make any noises or show any aggressive behavior, but it really scared me. Thanks, Nance. I hope I get to hear you telling this one. April 15, early morning, 6 a.m. or so. The day was supposed to be overcast, so we expected to be out fishing a good while that day. This was on the Allegheny River in Pennsylvania. I lived in Warren, Pennsylvania at that time, which is on the river. But I grew up further up the river, so I know it well. I was out with my friend Derek. We were out that day, hoping for some smallmouth bass. We had gone out east of Warren, but we weren't so far as the dam. We'd had good fishing around there before, and we were hoping for more of the same. We parked, and then we made our way out through to the bank of the river. As we came out through a cluster of trees and brush, we came to a clearing on the river bank that we had used before. At this time, we had dawn twilight blue around us. The sun was not up yet. We got busy, set up, and got to fishing. There was no talking, and there was no sound other than the river. And then, when we heard movement out in the trees behind us, it was very obvious. It started just a few minutes after we had set up to fish. I really wasn't concerned, but I was getting irritated. I thought, whoever it was, if they came much closer stomping around like they were going to scare off any fish that might be there. Then we heard the sound veer off to the west of us. I thought, great, they're going away. I never did see them. At that point, visibility more than about 50 feet from us wasn't possible. It was just too dark to see still yet. We continued fishing for a while. We weren't getting any bites, but we were patient men. I had been keeping a watchful eye down the west part of the bank. I didn't know of anything dangerous in the area, other than other people. But all the same, I was curious about what had made all that noise. After about 20 minutes, the sky was starting to lighten up, and we had blue light all around us on the ground. I hadn't heard any other noise, and I had stopped looking down the west bank. But Derek, who was standing to my left, came close to me, nudged my shoulder with his, and said, "What the heck is that?" And he nodded down the west bank. I looked over, and I saw a dark lump, maybe 3 feet tall and about as wide, sitting on the bank. I knew it was too wide to be any kind of a tree stump, and I kept squinting at it to try to see it better, and I was shocked when I saw slight movement. Now we were both curious, and I said to Derek, "I don't know what that is. You think it's another fisherman out here?" Now that sounds off to hear about me saying that now, but I thought that at the time. Or I thought maybe it was somebody hunting out of season, because the more I looked at it, the more I was sure I could see a texture, and I thought maybe it was a hunter wearing one of those shaggy camouflage suits they wear. I'm sorry, I can't think of what it's called right now. But something was wrong with all of it, and Derek and I both knew it. If it was a person out there, they'd been out there watching us for a long time. Now, I know one thing is true. People don't sit and watch other people from a distance in the darkness like that unless they mean you harm or they have a plan to do something bad that they shouldn't be doing. They just don't. Now, bad things had happened sometimes all around in that area, but always much deeper in the forest. And by the forest, I mean the Allegheny National Forest, which followed that river in the area, as well as being near the state game lands. We were not in either of those proper, but we were still wary of odd things, and usually those odd things involved humans up to no good, like maybe somebody watching us in the dark for 20 or 30 minutes or more. That's when Derek unzipped his jacket, and I heard the soft snicker snap of the inner pocket where I knew he kept his handgun. He didn't pull it out, but I knew he was just making ready. He did this as he stepped around me and walked a few feet towards the west part of the bank, and he called out to what he thought was a person. He said, "Hey there, is there something you want? You need some help?" He had no more than said that, and hadn't even finished it, really, when suddenly that 3-foot-high lump became an over 7-foot-tall lump. You talk about almost falling in the river, Nance. I almost did. I stepped back so fast. Derek was stepping back, too, but more slowly and surely than me. It still wasn't dawning on either of us what we might be dealing with. I really was going through all kinds of thoughts on what it might be, and I mostly came back to it had to be a human, because I could make out what I thought were arms and legs and all those kinds of things. Never once did I think it might be a bear and have my mind reject it. I don't know how anyone can look at one of those creatures and ever think it's a bear, not for one second. There's no ears sticking out. There's not a long nose and a mouth. And if it's standing up, a bear's legs look all wonky when they walk. It doesn't look at all like a human. Bear legs are really short in comparison to the rest of them, usually. When they stand up, their height is all the length of their body, not their legs. So no, to answer the question that I've been asked 100 times over when I have talked to people about this, no, there is no way it could have been a bear. I never even thought it might be. Like I said, I didn't think it and then reject it. It just wasn't there to think about, even as some kind of mistaken identity. I'm sorry, Nance, but I've been asked too many times this exact thing by people who try over and over to pin me on getting me to say that it was a bear, or that it might have been a bear, it could have been a bear, I thought it was a bear. No, I never once thought it might be. So now the lump was standing up, and I saw it wasn't just some lump. I didn't know what it was going to do. I still wasn't processing what it was, but I did work it out soon enough. Now, this moment seemed like it went on forever, but it was really probably only a minute in real time. It's standing there. The sun is now lightening up the sky enough that we could see it well enough to know what it definitely wasn't, but not crystal clear on what it was. And by the way, we were downwind of it that day, and I never smelled anything animal-like that I hear people talk about. But it sure knew that we were looking at it. I say it because I never saw proof one way or the other of male or female. The body I could see was just a dark object. Outline of it was more and more visible the more I looked and the more the sky was lightening up. I could tell for sure that there was a texture of fur on it. But if there were breasts or other things, I couldn't make them out looking straight on at the creature. I can tell you the fur was definitely a dark brown, and Derek agrees with me. How do we know that in the darkness? Well, because it was just a bit lighter than all the darkness that was behind it, which did fade out to a darker color than the creature. Now, if you've ever looked at something out under twilight skies, either in the early dawn or the evening hours, you'll know what I'm talking about. You can see differentiation in that blue light, but you can't tell exactly color. I don't know if it was shaggy, clean, dirty, short, or long fur. I couldn't tell you that, but I do know it wasn't full black. But something also was telling my brain there was a texture of fur there that I was seeing. The head didn't look oval-shaped to me, but again, I was looking at it straight on, and I couldn't be sure. Even when it eventually turned, I couldn't make out that detail. But let me tell you, there was no doubt for me or Derek, either of us, on its size. The girth and width that my eyes picked up was very unexpected, which is why we started backing up when it stood up. To say it was huge is an understatement. My eyes and brain immediately knew it. How it had gotten itself to look like a 3-foot-tall lump like it did? Nance, I don't know. I can't imagine it folding itself up like it did, but it did, I tell you. And watching it as it went from that 3-foot lump all the way to an upright, massive creature. What we saw, well, it was hard to describe. This staring at each other went on for maybe 20 or 30 seconds of the whole minute that I told you I think this really took. I somehow got the feeling that it was sizing us up. Were we a threat or what? We stood motionless once we finished backing up. I mean, I was afraid to breathe in case I made the thing mad. Then, all of a sudden, without warning, it just whirled around and it stomped off into the trees, making as much noise as it made when it came out. And as soon as it stepped into the darkness of the trees, it was definitely lost from our sight. But when it did that, you could still see that there were two legs as it walked. You could see how long they were, and you could see the arms swinging. There's no doubt, right then in my mind, what we had just seen. In shock, I said to Derek, We just saw a Bigfoot. We saw Bigfoot. We just saw a Bigfoot. I said it over and over, I think because I was in shock, and Derek wasn't answering me. Then he said, I know, shut up. I need to listen for it. I should add here that Derek is also a hunter, and while I had been hunting a couple times when I was a teenager, it was never my thing. So I shut up and I let him listen. Then Derek said he was pretty sure it was still nearby, but he didn't think that it meant us any harm. He could see I was upset, and he a few minutes later said, don't worry, it's left the area. I didn't know what to believe, and I wasn't sure how he knew what he knew, and I was too nervous to stay there and fish no matter what, so I said, let's get out of here. He didn't argue with me. He said, okay. We started packing everything up, but before we left, Derek opened his bait bucket of crawdads, and he left it right there on the bank. I said, what did you do that for? And he said, well, he thought maybe it was just wanting some food. Maybe he could smell the crawdads. I thought that was ridiculous at first, but on the way home, I thought maybe that wasn't so ridiculous. But we did get out of there, and we called it a day for fishing that day. We've done other fishing up and down that river, nearby, and all kinds of other areas, but I've never seen anything like that again. I did tell a few people about this, like I said, and they all tell me it was a bear. I'm imagining things. I'm making it up. They try anything to make me say that it was a bear. I tell you again, it was not a bear, and that's the honest truth, and I'm tired of saying it. Derek, he doesn't talk too much about it, and he sure won't tell other people in general. He said it's best that we don't tell other people. Not because he's worried that people will make fun of him or not believe us. Actually, he says just the opposite. He says, what if people do believe us? They do believe there's a Bigfoot out there, and they go in and they start hunting it. Please don't do that. It didn't harm us. It had lots of time and lots of cover of darkness for that if it wanted to. I'm not saying Bigfoot is all friendly and cuddly and what. I'm just saying that one didn't seem to want to hurt us. Maybe it was really just hoping for some free food. Of course, some might be friendly, but take it on a case by case. Don't hunt them, though, and don't think they're your friends. They are wild animals. And if they are out there, there's probably very few left in the world as it is. Please don't kill them. Thanks. You can just sign me using my nickname that everyone calls me, Duffy. Hello. I have been listening to your stories for about a month now, and I really love the stories. I have a lot of adventures that I was told by family, friends, parents, grandparents, etc. I am Native American from Washington State. I prefer not to say my name, but I will tell a story that my siblings to this day remember. When we were kids, there was a wooded area next to my aunt's little house. We lived across the street with trees behind our house, but we loved to play and explore next to my aunt's. It was when the internet was just getting started, you know, dial-up AOL, and me and my cousin were on there. The kids that were out in the woods, the oldest about 10 or 11 years old, well, we didn't know and we didn't care at that time where or what they were doing. But we should have, though. Our siblings didn't tell us anything, so we didn't know that they had entered a Sasquatch's home and had played with their kid. Nighttime fell, and I tried to stay the night with my cousin. Her mom went dancing, and she was going to be home alone babysitting her siblings. but my mom said no and that I had to get home. I looked outside. It was dark out, and I got the heebie-jeebies just looking out there. I always did. I slammed the door, and I asked my cousin to watch me run home and not to shut her door until I made it safely inside. She agreed. I checked my shoes and prepared to run. I got to my door and looked back at her and waved good night. As I got inside, I went straight to bed. Back then, my sisters and brothers all shared a room, and we had a pair of bunk beds. I was on top of one, and my brother, the oldest boy, was on top of the other bunk. In the middle of the night, I remember waking up to my grandpa waking my sister and brothers and forcing them to accompany him in the middle of the night. Apparently, my cousin called him crying. We lived with him, my grandma, our two uncles, and mom and dad. My dad heard the ruckus and opened their bedroom door and asked, "What's going on?" I pretended to be sleeping. I heard him tell my dad that my cousin called crying because something was pounding on the walls and the doors and the windows. She was home alone, and the youngest was only 2, I think. They were scared and crying. My grandpa, with shotgun in hand, walked over to see what was going on. It was the Sasquatches. They told my grandpa in dialect that the kids had entered their home when they were sleeping, which is very disrespectful, and played with their baby, not letting them sleep. So they went to pay it back, sorta. They were going to speak to a bunch of kids home alone. They agreed to drop it if all the kids apologized and agreed to never do it again. So my grandpa got the kids out in the woods and made them all one by one say their sorries and agreed to never enter their home again. After that, we would leave food out in the tree line, and when we forgot or didn't, we would get small rocks, nuts, or berries tossed at us. And that's just one story. If anyone wants to hear more, blow it up in comments and you will have plenty more. Signed, Strawberry Indian Girl. Hi, Nance. Thank you for your channel. I became quite addicted to listening about a year and a half ago, and I find it soothing, entertaining, and, well, a great place to come to take my mind off the madness of the world today. I do have my own story to tell, but I have hesitated to tell it because I never actually saw the Bigfoot. First, I will tell you a little bit about me and why I am so certain my experience was truly a Bigfoot experience. I am a retired peace officer. I worked with the great city of New York, NYPD, and then eventually moved on and retired out of a small rural community as a deputy sheriff in the High Sierras of California. Yep, I was in Bigfoot Central out there. I worked 980 square miles, oftentimes by myself, and the area was high desert, rural mountains. I used to spend my days off hiking and exploring the woods. But despite all this time in the High Sierra Mountains, I never heard or saw a Bigfoot. In fact, I was not a believer, and me and my friends even used to poke fun at quote-unquote believers. We named one of our quad stops Sasquatch Corner, because there was a huge pile of debris there from Forest Service work, and we always got the Bigfoot researchers coming through, confusing bears for Bigfoot and Forest Service work for Bigfoot activities. I retired out on a back injury a few years ago and ended up buying another very rural property out here in the White Mountains of New Mexico, just over the Arizona border. I live way up on a mesa, and the one road to get up here is an extremely steep, dangerous switchback that was cut into the mountain. There are only a handful of other people living up here, and my nearest neighbors are 1.5 miles away. Because the road is so bad and dead ends at my property, I don't ever see people or vehicles up here. I'm not much of a people person after seeing the kinds of things that people do to each other. I moved out here because I just wanted to be at peace and be left alone. And truthfully, I'd far prefer Bigfoot for neighbors than humans. I moved into my house September 2018 and knew that I would be snowed in up here as the roads are not passable in bad weather. The first snowfall, I went out and explored my property. I have beautiful cliffs and rock outcroppings, and I wanted to enjoy the fresh air and first snowfall. My land is 40 acres and surrounded by a huge subdivision in front of me, where no one has purchased the land, and then I have state and BLM land on the other sides of me. So I am way out here all alone. In the snow, I walked to the backside of my property towards the outcroppings. When I hit the outcropping, I noticed these massive footprints, human footprints, not shoes or boots, but feet with toes, and they were very, very large. These were not bear prints. My mind could not make sense of it, so I tried desperately to convince myself that someone had some human foot-shaped snowshoes, and they were just joking around, messing, you know, with the new guy in town, perhaps. But why on the backside of my property, and in an area where everyone knows, well, you will get shot for trespassing in these parts? But the real thing I could not figure out was how the footprints came up from and seemed to go back down the rock outcropping. These are not easy outcroppings to navigate, and certainly not in snow wearing any kind of snowshoes. Time went by, and nothing else happened, and I almost forgot about it. As I settled in, I began to explore further out into the Apache and Gila wilderness. While on one of these hikes off trail, way out in the middle of nowhere, I heard a crash. I immediately dismissed it as a squirrel or something jumping from a tree. Though the rational brain knew a squirrel was not heavy enough to make such a noise, no other noise followed, and so I could not fill in the mental gap. I did not hear any footsteps or anything else that made me believe that I had spooked a deer or elk. Once again, I let it go and continued my hike up a dry, ephemeral creek, looking for cool rocks. I keep having a feeling I was being watched, but when I would look up, especially to my left, which is where my gut kept telling me to look, I would see or hear nothing, and so I would return to looking down for rocks. And then I was hit with this horrific smell. Now, I was not only a police officer and firefighter in New York City, where I saw, heard, and definitely smelled it all. But I had also been a coroner, and I know the smell of death all too well. I can certainly distinguish between a dead human body and dead animal, and this was neither. It smelled more like a loaded city garbage truck combined with a subway station restroom, with a mustiness and gangrenous rotting flesh. I looked around everywhere, but did not see or hear anything. I went further up the creek, and it seemed to stay with me. The whole time, I had a distinct feeling that I was being watched, and I couldn't figure out why the smell wasn't dissipating as I moved. Eventually, I turned around and headed back. Almost immediately upon heading back, the smell dissipated and was gone. The wretched smell just disappeared. This got me to thinking about the footprints again, and that is when I started to give Bigfoot a bit more space in my mind. But here is where it really gets good. Out here in New Mexico, they say whiskey is for drinking and water is for fighting over. And boy, are they right about that. Without getting too much into the insanity of my current situation, I will tell you that last October 2019, my property suffered a total loss of water down my creeks, which subsequently shut my well down. The creeks are ephemeral, so when it rains, they used to flow beautifully, fill up my ponds, and wrap around to drop off the waterfalls at the outcroppings. The well and the creeks were why I purchased the property, and now suddenly, I had no water at all. Eventually, I walked up the creek and discovered that about a mile up, on public land, someone had totally rerouted my creek and sent it into a fully enclosed dam. I was furious. I thought it was the state, which made me more mad. But later, I discovered that there was a rancher on the other side of the mesa who leases that public land. Now, there were cattle drinkers all over which were full of water year-round, so the installation of a huge dam didn't make sense to me until I discovered that these folks, most of these wealthy, old-school, aristocratic landowners, all run these very profitable hunting outfits. They install these dams to fish pond the elk. I figured these people just didn't realize that I was here, and also assumed that they would be normal folks who would understand and remedy the situation. Well, I was wrong. To this day, I shower from store-bought water that I put into a camping solar shower. So much for a comfortable retirement. And that's not the worst of it either. But I'll spare you all the details of that. Now, not only am I partially physically disabled from my work-related back injury, but I was also in a pretty bad motorcycle accident, and the whole right side of my body is just weak and in constant pain, and I walk with a slight limp on bad days. But I'll tell you what, I can be bullheaded, and I had every intention of getting my water back. These people had heavy machinery to install these massive dams. I had a shovel, a rock hammer, a lever, and willpower. Anyone who doesn't know New Mexico land, well, I'll tell you, it's all rock. And I mean rock. Rock and more rock. I would hike out to the area where they bulldozed a huge wall through the natural creek, and I began chipping away. My rock hammer and the shovel would make quite a bit of banging and popping noises. Not too unlike that of whacking a tree, I suppose. And that's when I started to hear it. The knocking back. Now, no one was out in these parts. And if they were, I would have heard them coming from miles away. The rancher who had made these alterations was about another mile away, as the crow flies, and none of these roads were easy to travel around. This was loud, sporadic tree knocking coming from 50 to 100 yards or so west of me. It seemed to answer when I either hit rocks with my rock hammer or whistled to it. I would whistle, it would knock. It got to a point where it would even mimic my pattern of short whistle. If I whistled 3 times, it knocked 3 times. This knocking began to occur every day I went out. One day, as I rode my quad back to my place, I would stop and shut my engine off, and I could hear this thing following me. It was paralleling me down the creek, and whacking the crap out of trees as it did so. When I got to my property, I would whistle, and it would send back a loud knock right in my tree line. No human could have paralleled me down that creek that fast. And it easily hopped my fence and was actually on my property in the tree line that particular day. By this time, I was fairly certain that there was more than one. The next time I hiked up that creek, there were trees, live trees, about 6 inches in diameter, and they were clearly broken in half. Now, the last day I went out there, as soon as I arrived and shut my engine off, I was met with knocks. I not only felt that I was being watched, but I was certain the knocks were communicating with me. I felt they did not like my quad or my presence. I realized later that I think they responded to my rock hammering, and that drew them in. So on this last day, I got my rock hammer out, and I began to chip away at the big dam, when all of a sudden, and I mean in a split second, I felt what my brain registered as a herd of elk stampeding past me through the creek directly to my left in what would I have estimated to be about 10 to 15 feet. I would say buffalo, but I know the largest animal that could make this kind of sound in this area would be elk, so that was what my brain processed, or tried to process, as this all played out. But Nance, I never saw anything. No dust kicked up. No trees moving. Nothing. Now, from the direction that it came, it was pretty open, and I am always on alert and highly aware of my surroundings. Whatever stampeded past me, it had snuck up on me with such silence and stealth, and then moved with such speed and force, that I detected nothing as it approached. My brain was rapidly playing out any and every animal that I could think of that could have snuck up with such stealth and also made so much noise while actually vibrating the ground and my body. I mean, I felt this or these things stampede past me. Every hair on my body was raised up. I've seen and been through a lot, having worked in the projects of New York City, and never did every hair on my body stand on end until that moment. Now, as soon as the loud, heavy noise happened, I was also up on my feet and moving rapidly to my right, away from whatever it was, thinking I would be run over. And I instinctively drew my sidearm and concealed myself next to a cedar tree. While all of this was occurring, I was also looking around rapidly for whatever it was. With that kind of noise, force, vibration, I was certain I would have to see something, and I was mostly still stuck on it being elk. But they had crossed the dry creek too fast and into the heavily wooded area, and yet not a single branch broke. Dead silence. As I had moved to get cover at the cedar tree about 5 to 7 yards from where I had been, I had also instinctively drawn my firearm, and, as though in response to that action, I then heard the loudest, most bone-chilling, screeching scream type of sound. Well, there was no recognizing this noise, and it was piercing. I have heard mountain lions, bears, elk, you name it. This was like an elk being horrifically tortured, while a mountain lion's scream was mixed in, and I could not see or hear it outside that scream at all. But intuitively, it's like it just knew. As soon as I pulled my firearm out, it was pissed, and it let me know it. Now, I could also sense that it was right near me, but I could not see or hear anything at all. And you could hear a pin drop at this point. No birds, no wind, no nothing except my own breathing, which by this time had that numbing, heart-throbbing, deafening noise response occurring in my ears. As soon as I heard that scream, though, where one might think that's the time to raise the gun and let off a shot, something told me not to. Instead, I slowly holstered my gun, and I softly said, "I'm not going to hurt you." Now, I never heard or saw anything. It could not have been elk. They would have been crashing through the woods. It could not have been a cat because, well, I'd be dead for one. And a cat just doesn't have the weight to make that kind of a stampede sensation. And a bear? Well, that doesn't fit at all. None of these animals makes this type of sound. Whatever it was, I feel, it had tremendous cloaking ability and tremendous ability to remain utterly stealthy. But it wanted me to know that it did not like me out there at the creek making banging noises, like hitting a tree, and it certainly seemed to know what my firearm was, and it did not like that at all, either. Nance, I have had no other experiences, mainly because I can no longer hike, and I can no longer enjoy my land. But that's a whole nother story. I sincerely believe Bigfoot migrate through here on their way back down to the valley in the thickness of the woods by the rim down in Arizona, in the areas where Bigfoot are known to be. I think the ranchers' drinkers are what bring them through here, since there's no water anywhere else nearby. I wish I could have seen it or them and been able to give you more details. But I can tell you what, I am a full believer now, despite never having actually seen one. God bless and keep up the enjoyable stories. Signed, Jackson. My name is Julie. I'm 51 now. In 1988, Dad and I went to Yellowstone to celebrate high school graduation. We drove to a picnic spot behind the Lodge of Yellowstone. I got out the plates and the knives and the forks, and I started to grill. All of a sudden, I felt something watching me, and I was very scared. Rock One came flying at my head. I put out the grill, and I ran to the car. Rock Two hit the bumper. I look up, and on the ridge, what I saw was 10 feet, dark chocolate brown, no neck, bipedal creature. We left, and we told the park police. They laughed at me, and they said I saw a bear. Now, I have since studied wildlife, forestry, conservation, animal science, birds, and virology. I know what I saw, and I was so terrified, we left and went back to California. I have refused to go into the woods ever since. They do not want us there. I turned with my camera, and I got one shot with four creatures in it. I sent that to Dr. Meldrum. Now, the big guy, you can see him shaking the tree behind me. There's one to my left, one to my right, and one behind me. I was being hunted. The park management at the park does not want to spook people, but there are markers all over the park and in the canyon. I know what I saw. I am not doing this for attention. I am not lying. I saw it, and I will never be the same again. Say a prayer when you enter the woods. I live west of Texarkana, which means I'm well on the Texas side, but I'm close enough to drive into work every day. But say Texarkana, and people go right to the Town That Dreaded Sundown movie, all about the murders back in 46. And we did. We did dread sundown at my place, all right. But for a different reason, and in a different year. The reason stunk like 3-day-old roadkill and wasn't much prettier to look at. And the year was 2016, not 1946. And that year, you might as well say that it took the whole garden. It also liked to peek in at us inside the house. More than once that year, Judy, my wife, or Krista, my daughter, would suddenly be kicking up a loud fuss because something was looking in the window at it. I only caught it looking in one time, and that only went like that because of the smell coming in that made me know it was there. I looked up, and there it was, and then it was gone. I believe it's lots of places out this way. I know someone that works up at the Red River Army Depot, and he said they've seen one of them more than once up there. There's lots of unused space, and he said he thinks they're living up there. Makes sense. Not dense with people there. There's water there and lots of trees all over. I bet they could live just fine up there with no one ever bothering them. Once it gets dark, you know right away when they're around. Millie, our dog. Now, let's say that Millie is what you would call pure American, Heinz 57, who knows what kind of mix, but it's a huge mix kind of mutt with a shelter pedigree. Well, Millie starts making all kinds of little whining noises and starts pressing hard into you with her whole body. If I'm sitting in my chair, she tries to get under me and starts nosing behind me like she's going to sit behind me in my chair. Now, Millie's just plain too big for that, and so am I. But she tries anyway when they're nearby. The first time, I didn't know what was wrong with the dang dog. But then that smell came in through the window. And about that time, Judy starts her yelling from the kitchen. And she's saying it's out there in the yard. It was almost dark out, but you could still see it from the window. It was out there pulling up stuff from our garden. It wasn't taking just food. It was taking the whole daggone plant. And that night, it got itself a whole cucumber vine and just dragged the whole thing away, leaving half the cukes all over when it fell off. But I guess having the other half still on the vine made it worth its while. But by the end of summer, I was so dag-blasted mad I could have shot that thing out of pure meanness. We didn't get hardly nothing from that garden that year, thanks to that Sasquatch. Now, I never saw it in sun or day. I also think there's more than one that comes up to our house. In fact, I know there is for sure. I've seen two really big ones, and of those, one is much bigger than the other. I believe both to be male. Their build is huskier than the other three that I've seen. The other three, I think, are female, and of them, the biggest one is still smaller than the smallest of the two males. Now, I've seen them all at different times. Our garden isn't the only thing they go after. Weirdly, we've had clothes go missing off the line. Now, we've lived here for more than 15 years at that point, and we had never lost anything off the line that we couldn't look around and see right where it was and go get it. We also had one of those metallic yard globe things go missing. It was a bright, shiny metallic gold, and it was setting out on a metal stand out in the tree line just where it caught some sun. Now, I had glued the globe to the rim of the metal stand so that wind or deer or whatever wouldn't knock it out of the stand and break it. As for the metal stand, I put great big landscaping pins in the curled up parts of each leg. I did that to secure it deep in the ground. The whole danged thing was taken, though, not just the globe. The whole thing was pulled straight up from the ground. You could see right where the pins had been. And no, a neighbor couldn't have taken it. It couldn't even be seen unless you were on my property at the back. And I can tell you, I'm not that friendly with my neighbors that any of them have ever been in the back of my property. You cross my property, and 100 lights will kick on. And if you're a human, Millie will lose her mind, and we all hear it. But nothing happened that night. So whatever came and took my globe, it didn't cross my property. It came in from the woods. We saw them several times that year. There were lots of other little things happening, too. Sometimes we would go out in the woods, and we'd start finding things that had been going missing and things that they'd taken. They was just here and there, dropped wherever. I guess whenever they got bored of checking it out or looking at it. But not our laundry, which was really weird, I thought. I never found a single piece of our laundry that went missing. A few times, we heard things out there that we ain't heard before or since. I reckon they was just passing through that year, because it's been all quiet on my home front since then, and none of us fear sundown anymore, not since 2016. Thanks. Keep me anonymous, please. We live in Utah, but we went up there with my wife's sister and husband to Canada. My brother-in-law was born in Canada, and although he was born in a city, he likes to make out like he's some big outdoorsman. He isn't. Gladstone National Park. We stayed at the Texas Creek Campground. We were in campers because, you know, my brother-in-law is such a big outdoorsy guy that he has the plushest camper van you've ever laid eyes on to sleep in. But whatever, right? The place is beautiful. The lake is beautiful. My brother-in-law was not beautiful that morning. He was actually feeling queasy from the night of heavy drinking we'd all had the night before. Me and my wife were okay, so we left them and headed out on our own. We like to stay off the beaten path when we can, so we headed out towards the east into a natural floor between two ridges. We were down in the trees, but it was easy walking. We had been walking for just over an hour. And then I kept hearing big wood breaks all around us. Some came from the front, and it sounded like others were farther away. And it didn't sound like bighorn sheep crashing through the trees. I didn't think they'd be down on the floor of the forest anyway where we were. I did know, however, that there were grizzly bears in that area. We were told, though, that they weren't very common. I had bear spray with me, and I had never used it, and I hoped that I would never use it, and certainly not for the first time to test it against a grizzly bear. The idea of me, or rather the mental image I had of me standing there with a spray can facing off against a grizzly bear, well, my brain said that would be as effective as a screen door on a submarine, and that it just wasn't a good idea to try. A big grizzly, though, was the only thing that I could think of making those kinds of noises in the trees. Now, unlike my brother-in-law, I don't claim to be some big outdoors guy, and I wasn't sure, but I thought sometimes grizzlies were known to knock trees down, the old dead ones anyway. I mean, I didn't know, but it's what made sense to me and my wife at that moment as we whispered about it. We had stopped, and we were trying to get a fix on the direction of the sounds. And sometimes it sounded like they were far away ahead of us, sometimes very close to us. And then for a while, all the sounds stopped. I was trying to make sure that we weren't about to walk smack into a grizzly. We waited several minutes, and then we decided it was time to move on, but time to move on back to the campground. So we reversed direction. We no more than started, and there it went again, the sound of big breaks and wood snaps. We're looking all around, but we don't see anything. We kept walking, but you could hear more like a creak and a snap, like something was pushing a tree. And then I heard a very different noise all of a sudden, not quite a grunt or a growl, and it wasn't far away at all. It sounded like a chest vibration from a large animal. My wife and I looked at each other as if to say, "What the heck was that?" We neither one had ever heard anything like that. As a kid, I loved to watch that old show, that Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom. And there was this episode, and it had a big male lion, and he was making this throaty call very softly. Now, that's the closest I can think of. And when I say softly, I mean softly for an African lion. But if you take that sound and kick it down still a couple more notches in volume, and you take off all the harsh edges, that's what I was hearing out there in the trees. I did, in that second, think about the African lion. But I knew there were no African lions in that area, and I didn't think there were any big cats at all. But that really was my first thought, some kind of big cat. My second thought was maybe that it was a bear doing that weird huffing thing, like when they stand and bounce on something and the air gets forced out of their lungs. If you've ever seen that, that's what I was thinking about. But it still wasn't quite right either. Now, all of this was going on in my head all at once in about 1/1000th of a second. I'm standing there, shoulder to shoulder with my wife, but we're both turned just slightly, looking at each other, talking about it. Then I see her lean a little more to look past me. Her eyes get big, and her mouth opens. She's looking right past me. My stomach drops, and I turn, and I look. Yep, big old Sasquatch was standing there. 10 yards away, 12 yards max, I would say. And I used to play football in college, so I'm really good at knowing my yardages on sight from different viewing perspectives. He was standing straight up. He wasn't hiding one bit. Big and reddish-brown in color. The fur was very neat-looking, about 2 inches long, and did not hang loose away from the body. I knew right away. This wasn't some episode of Scooby-Doo where somebody was trying to get away with something wearing some shaggy-looking monster costume. Oh, no, this was the real deal, and I could tell. It stood right at 10 feet tall, and as clear as day, I could see it breathing. I'm just over 6'6" tall. Yes, I'm a very big man. I mentioned I played football. I was an offensive lineman, middle position, when I played football, so you know I'm not a small guy. And when I say that that thing made me feel like a dwarf in comparison, that actually means something. Feeling dwarfed by anything isn't something that has happened much at all in my life. I should also tell you that I'm a black man. My wife is white. I say this because it's also very important, I think. I don't like to generalize, but in my experience, not a lot of us black folk go out in the wilds camping. I am, however, seeing more and more of us out there. But there was a time that I was always the odd one out wherever we went. And it's even more pronounced in Canada, where the percentage of black population is minuscule. So, for all I know, I might have been the first black person that Sasquatch has ever seen. Maybe I confused it. Maybe, just maybe, it saw me from a great distance and thought that I was some young, hairless, maybe, rival-looking male trespassing in his area. I don't even know. Sounds crazy, I know. But this whole thing was crazy. I can't even guess what was going through its mind at that moment. But I can tell you beyond a doubt that it was looking at me, not my wife. It was looking at me. We had direct eye contact, sustained. It was not interested in my wife, as far as I could tell. Now, my hair is shaved pretty close up to my head, but right then, I felt like I had 10-inch long hair that was standing right up off my scalp. From the second I made eye contact with that thing, it was pure intimidation all the way. I'm a football player, like I said. I know about mean looks and guys trying to intimidate one another. There's no doubt it was out to intimidate. Then, right after that, it changed a little bit, like it was confused by me, like it had a look at me, and it didn't know what to think. Me? I'm standing there, and I'm still scared like nothing else in my whole life. I was standing in front of my wife now. I pushed her behind me. I got out the bear spray. I faced down some of the biggest and meanest men on a football field that you could ever imagine. But right now, I'm out here with no padding, no helmet, and I'm about to maybe take on the King Daddy of all King Daddy mean ones. And you bet your sweet you-know-what that I was scared you-know-whatless. I wasn't going to do anything, I said to myself, unless it did something. It was just looking at me. And the intensity of that stare had now lost some of the intimidation. And it changed to something a little more like bored contempt. Like it had just figured out that I was just some dumb old human and I had just wasted its time. Now, I had just said that I told myself that I wasn't going to do anything at all unless it did something first, right? I was lying, only I didn't know it. Because you see, that stupid part of my brain, the one that took one too many knocks when I was a young kid and I was stupid and I played touch football with my friends out in a concrete parking lot, with no helmet or padding, because, you know, that's all we had in the city. Well, that same me that took those hard knocks and whacks to the head on the concrete, well, that part of my brain decided now was a good time to step up, and it had its own plan of action. And before I knew it, that stupid part of my brain commanded me to step forward and make myself big by raising my arms and yelling at it, like I was just dealing with some black bear that just needed to be told it better get on home because mama was looking for it. Big mistake. Now that Sasquatch mimicked me, it too was suddenly making itself bigger, but it was baring some ugly teeth, and it started to seriously growl. It took a half step forward, but just enough to give it some leverage, I think, because then it took a leap and covered half the distance between us, landing 15 feet from me. I do mean 5 yards. Now, the stupid part of my brain suddenly shut up and decided it was a good time to take a seat and, you know, let the smarter part of my brain step up and do its job. But the smarter part of my brain, yeah, it was busted. It had nothing. But I did what I had been taught, and I went down to my middle linebacker lean. And thinking back on it now, that too probably was not the smartest move, but it was instinct. I did that, and the Sasquatch let out a roar that left my ears ringing. Now, I didn't dare move at all. We were at a stalemate. It was close enough, I could smell the musk of the fur, which, by the way, wasn't terrible. It was like what you'd smell from the family dog if you put your nose into its fur. My wife had dropped down behind me as well. I whispered for her to stay quiet. I could hear her trying to breathe. Later, she told me she was shaking so hard in fear that she could hardly catch her own breath. So there I was in what I now think of as my suicide position, because there was no way I could tackle and drop this Sasquatch. It would be a suicide mission because I only had one hope, and that it would be just enough to buy time for my wife to run like hell. I hadn't even been able to tell her that that was my plan. I just hoped that if it happened that she would know enough to run. But then something happened. The Sasquatch, who had lowered his head and also pulled his shoulders inward like he was going to charge me, suddenly straightened up a little bit, and the growling that had started up again right after he roared had stopped. I saw him sniffing the air while keeping his eyes on me. My ears were still ringing a bit from his roar, but I could hear it. I heard what he heard. I heard another big Sasquatch roar somewhere further on up on the ridge floor, roughly in the direction that I had been hearing other tree-snapping sounds. Then that big, furry shithead of a Sasquatch, I'm sorry to say that, but he really was, he did the most disrespectful and awful thing that I've ever had an opponent do. He leaned down just enough to drag his long arm backward, and in a motion that happened so fast I almost didn't see it coming, he scooped up a handful of dirt and rock and flung them right in my face. I couldn't see. I now had dirt and tiny gravel pieces all in my eyes, but I heard him. I heard that butthole running away. You could feel the ground shake. And then I heard a roar. I think it was his. He was answering the other one. At that moment, I'm in a panic, and I'm trying to get all of the rock and dirt out of my eyes, and I'm also desperate to get us out of there. I'm telling my wife, Jacinda, I said, get us out of here, right now. I'm holding on to her as she's trying to lead us out. All the while, I'm trying to walk as fast as I could behind her, keep up with her, and I'm trying to flush out my eye with what water I had in my water bottle. It was excruciating, just trying to keep one eye open up enough that I could see where I was going and not fall. But also, in the back of my mind, I was praying that my sweet wife knew which way to go, because if not, I was using up all the water I had, and that wouldn't be good if we got lost or became stranded overnight or longer. So, I'm sorry my long story keeps going. I would say sorry to you, but I really need to say sorry to sweet Jacinda, my wife. She's the one that's been typing all of this up for me. I type with two fingers. I take forever, and, well, I'll be blunt. Football is what got me into college, not my grades, and certainly not my typing or my words. When we got back to the campground, my eyes were still in bad shape and swollen. It was awful. But I was so mad by then, I wanted to go back and find that butthole of a Sasquatch. I wanted to beat him to a bloody pulp. I probably wouldn't stand a chance, but I was feeling braver now that I was back at the campground. My brother-in-law, when we told him, laughed and said we made it all up. And then he got mean about it. Me? I was still having trouble seeing. We packed up anyway and pulled out. I wasn't dealing with that butthole either. Jacinda is the one that drove us out of there, because I couldn't. I went, and I had to have some of the gravel chips extracted, by the way. Some of them had slipped down, and they were so tiny and were embedded now in my lower inner eyelid. The doctor said that it probably happened when I reflexively rubbed my eyes. Well, better that than sunk deep inside the eyeball itself. So a Sasquatch almost blinded me that day. Now, me and Jacinda, we've talked about it an awful lot, and we wonder if maybe we weren't just in the wrong area at the wrong time. Maybe that Sasquatch, maybe he was aware that there was a rival somewhere in the area trespassing in his territory. And maybe from a distance, I know this sounds weird, but maybe he thought I was the rival. Maybe from a distance, he didn't realize I didn't have fur. He just saw a dark being. Is it possible? Could that be? I don't know. But like I said, once it got close and it locked eyes with me, it seemed confused. I thought, and I still think, it was confused because it had never seen a black man before. To this day, I have no idea, but I'd like to know what other people think. Thanks. Just call me Big D. So sign us Big D and Jacinda. Hi, Buckeye Bigfoot. This happened in 1994, Jordan, West Virginia. Only thing I recall on that date was that it was during the week that happened after Easter that year. So, whenever that was in 1994. I only remember because my two cousins had come in on Good Friday, and they were staying with their mom and dads at our place for extra time while we were all out of school after Easter. We was teenagers, and we were probably driving the adults crazy, so they let us loose one day with the four-wheelers, mostly to keep us out of their hair. There were paths that crisscrossed not only our property, but went across a couple neighbors. No one cared who rode them, as long as we were all respectful. And beside the sound of the four-wheelers tearing back and forth all day, I reckon we was as respectful, well, as much as teenagers know how to be. Now, we had been told once or twice before that we'd better stay on the dirt path with those four-wheelers because there was some kind of creature in that area. As long as we stayed on the paths, they said, it wouldn't bother us. It's only when you got in the trees and the brush that it got aggressive and territorial. I didn't believe it. My cousins, I don't know if they believed it or not. Me, I'd lived there my whole life, and I had never seen it. But now that my cousins had heard about it, they decided we were going to go find it. So off we go on the four-wheelers. Now, they kept picking out parts of the road, and they kept trying to go off the dirt path and on into the woods. And I kept saying, no, we can't do that. That is private property. You can't do that. Now, my cousins lived up in Morgantown, and while that ain't exactly New York City, it sure wasn't Jordan, where it's a bit more rural, and we know there's just things you know better than to do. Like, trespassing is a really big no-no. It's the kind of dumb thing to do that could get you killed down here in those parts. Now, I knew that, but my city cousins, they didn't get how serious trespassing was. So it was lots of fighting to try to keep them on the dirt paths. Then all of a sudden, they took off tearing down on the left on one of the dirt bends. I couldn't let that go. I had to follow them. If they ran into one of these property owners, who would probably have his shotgun with him, well, I knew most of those property owners, and maybe, just maybe, I could talk him out of just shooting them where they stood. Maybe if I explained the situation and that they didn't know how things worked down there. I was 15 at the time, and I felt very grown up, and that seemed like a very reasonable thing to do for me. So off they go, and I'm following. Now, no one's going big throttle on the four-wheelers because we're now starting to have to pick our way through the trees and zigzag left and right around brush. I kept yelling at them. They was going to get stuck, and we were going to need to turn back, like, now. I kept telling them that the four-wheelers couldn't get through there or on up the hill where they were aiming. Finally, Russ, one of my cousins, had forged so far ahead that he immediately came into an area where the trees were just too close, and he was going to have to back out. He tried, and he stalled the old four-wheeler. But I knew that it had a thing going on for a while with it, that when it got real hot, it would stall out, And then you would have to wait till it cooled all the way down before you could even think about restarting it. I don't know what it was, but it had a high gasoline smell all of a sudden when it did this. Now, somebody out there will know what's going on probably from what I said, but I didn't know what it was, and I never did know, really, because Dad sold it not long after this incident. Now, I've gotten off track, so let me get back on. Now, me and Colin, my other cousin, had now shut our four-wheelers off. We got off, and we were going over to help pull his back out and try to manually turn it around. From there, if we were lucky, we might get a downhill run clear enough and get it started that way. Now, that had never happened with that four-wheeler, but I don't know that we had ever tried it either. We were only going to try that because Colin said that's how his dad always got their car to start when it wouldn't. Of course, their car was a stick shift, and the four-wheeler wasn't. But we three teenagers didn't understand that kind of difference. We didn't have the mechanical background. So there we are, we're standing there in a cluster you-know-what between us and all the four-wheelers around us. And then we heard a huge screeching sound like I don't know what. Nance, I tell you, it was worse and louder than a lion. It sounded like a woman being murdered mixed in with a big cat screaming, but so loud you felt it in your chest. We all three were scared at that. We didn't have any arms on us. Now, normally I did have a small handgun that I took out with me whenever I left our house. But my daddy said not to, as my cousins didn't have anything, and we didn't want to give them anything to carry, because Daddy said he didn't think they'd been taught right to handle it all. And the worst I'd ever seen when I'd gone out there was a snake. So we all figured it would be all right to go out unarmed. But it wasn't. We were all looking around, scared to death, and trying to act like we weren't. You gotta love the teenage male mind and ego, huh? So we start moving that four-wheeler, double fast now, and with it being dead weight, even on wheels, it was taking some effort. And trying to turn those wheels took muscle when it wasn't running. Colin stopped pushing, and then he said, "What is that?" And he was pointing up the incline of trees towards the hill. Big as day, there was a dark, hairy animal of some kind by a tree. It was in a round shape, and I first thought I was side-looking at a bear. That didn't scare me too much. But then it scooted around, and I could see knees and arms, and then I saw the face when it lifted it up a little bit. I saw the shine of eyes, like lint was glinting off of them from the sky. And if there hadn't been any light out there shining down, I wouldn't have seen those eyes. It was too dark. I mean, the fur and the face. Now, we're all three silent, and we had stopped pushing and pulling on the four-wheeler. "What is that?" Colin and Russ kept both asking me over and over. Then one of them said, "I bet that's the monster they were talking about." And I said, "Yes, I think so." And then I said, "I think we better get out of here." We left the broke-down four-wheeler. We kicked on the other two, and Russ and Colin rode double on one, and I picked our way out of there. Russ was on the back of Colin's four-wheeler, and his job was to keep watch and make sure it didn't come in after us. All he said was that it stood up when we started the four-wheelers, and it just stood there. That's when he was yelling, "Go, go, go," at us. And then, as we started going away, he said it stood there and watched a bit, and then it let out another scream, which we all heard. Then he said it looked like it threw something, like maybe a branch or something, in our direction. But it didn't even come halfway to where we were, so he wasn't worried about that. Then we got far enough away it was out of sight. When we got home, we told everyone, and didn't not a one of them believe us. My dad chewed us out for leaving the four-wheeler just sit. We had to go right back out with him and my uncle to show them where it was and get it home. And doesn't it figure? It made a liar out of us, and it started right up when we all got out there. But thankfully, my dad did know that it did that sometimes, so he did believe me on that at least, if not the rest of it. He was just mad that I had left it and not stayed there with it until it cooled down. The next day, my mother sent us over to our neighbor's with a couple big foil-covered paper plates of leftovers. Now, we did that a couple times a week, usually. Mr. Edward, our neighbor, or as we called him, Mr. Eddie, had been widowed a long time, and he didn't have much money, Mom said, and he only cooked every so often for himself. But Mom always sent him plates of our food through one of us kids. So us three teens took the stuff over, more as a chance to get out on the four-wheelers again, more than anything. So Mr. Eddie asks us if we're out having fun on those four-wheelers. And we said, yes, sir, and then we told him what had happened and what we had seen. That's when he got all serious, and he told us to be real careful of that thing. He said that it's been in those parts at least since he was a boy, which was a good 70 years. And he said it was known to kill anything it came across. Sometimes it killed for food, but lots of other times just for the heck of it, it seemed. It did not like to be surprised, and while it usually left humans alone, it didn't like us walking up on it, and it didn't like being near us at all. He said the only time that it was ever known to come near us humans was when it meant that it was up to no good. It meant that it was looking for something easy to take. It could be our livestock, could be our vegetables, or it could be a child. And he said that he had a lot of these stories told to him when he was growing up. I wish I could remember all that he told us that afternoon. We three teens were fascinated and probably spent 2 hours there with him. But mostly I remember him telling us over and over that it was not a friendly being, and if it ever comes close and tries to act friendly, that we need to run for our lives. The only other thing I remember is he said that when he was a little boy, there were some Choctaw that lived right down the road from him, and they are the ones who warned him early and over to never let it near him. He repeated a lot of their stories and legends, the ones the Choctaw told him, I mean. I do wish I remembered more of what he said that day. They fascinated me at the time. But like all teenagers, I listened. I picked out what I wanted to remember. And somehow through the years, the rest has faded away. I don't know if you'll use this or not on one of your videos, but if you do, you can go ahead and call me Hank Hill, because my business now really is propane and propane accessories. It's a big joke in my family, and they all just call me Hank now. Over the years, I've learned to answer to it. So thanks a lot, Hank. Nance, I haven't been able to tell anyone this story before, and not have them believe me anyway. But I think you and the Sasquad will listen, and I don't think you'll call me a liar. We used to go camping lots when I was little. My mom didn't enjoy it as much as my dad because, you know, all the work was on her, really, when we went camping, all the roughing it parts anyway. We were camping in Northern California. I don't recall the exact location. I was only 8, and after all these years, all those places have kind of ran together in my mind. I do remember that it was somewhere in the Tahoe National Forest. So this is sometime in August or maybe early September 1969. I only remember because of the Manson murders. Everyone tried to not let me hear about what had happened because I was only 8 years old. But you couldn't be anywhere, especially in California, and not hear about those awful murders. Of course, at that time, we weren't calling them the Manson murders. But I remember it well, because for the first time, I was scared to sleep out there when we went camping, because I thought that that murderer was going to come and get us. My dad explained over and over that that was many hours away. It was way down south in California, and it was in a city. At the time, I had no concept of just how far Southern California was from us at that point. All I heard was California, and I knew that was our state. I just couldn't shake that fear. So that's why I wasn't sleeping well. And every little noise that I heard had me wide awake. Before all this, I slept really well during our camping trips. I had had that blissful, safe feeling that you only get as a child when you're sleeping right between your mom and dad. One night, I heard a metal scraping noise that got me right up. Now, I knew it was our cooler. Our cooler was one of those big metal coolers and had a red plaid design all over it. Dad had taken the precaution of setting a huge rock on it. And I don't know if that's what I heard scrape or if it was the actual opening sound of metal on metal that I heard. But I heard something of that metal sound, and I was wide awake, and I knew what it was. And then I wasn't thinking murderer. I was thinking bear. Yeah, maybe I'd spent too much time watching Yogi Bear back then, but I had also been told about bears, so they wanted me to be careful. I was careful, and I had a respect for bears. But looking back, I realized I didn't have the fear of a bear that I should have had. Blame it on Yogi if you want, but I don't think that was it. It was just like I didn't understand and couldn't conceive just how far Southern California was from us. At the same time, I couldn't understand really how dangerous it was if a bear came into our camp. So, being a kid, I got on my knees and curiosity got the better of me. I hand and knee walked over to the tent flap. I looked out, but the fire was long gone. I thought I saw movement out there in the darkness. Something was moving, I knew, but there wasn't enough moon or starlight or campfire left to see. I did hear things being moved, but I couldn't always tell what. I thought about waking my mom or dad up, but for some reason I didn't. Probably because at one point or another, I had awakened them for something before, and it turned out to be a big nothing, and I got yelled at. So I decided, unless I knew it was dangerous, I wasn't going to wake them. After a while, whatever it was left, and I managed to fall back to sleep. But the next morning, I woke up to my mom yelling anyway. I even heard her curse, which was very unlike my mother. Someone or something had come into the camp and taken our stuff out of the cooler. The bread loaf and the buns had all been tossed out, gotten trampled on, and some looked like it had come out and was eventually eaten by other critters around us. The hot dogs that Mom had just gotten at the little store in the park the afternoon before, the ones that were supposed to be our lunch, well, they were gone. All of it in the cooler was gone or destroyed or ruined, because the cooler had also been left open all night. Now, Mom just knew it was the hippies down the way that we had ran into a few days before. Dad said it was probably a bear or a raccoon. Now, Mom hated hippies, though, so of course, in her mind, if it was bad and it happened, it had to be the hippies. So she wouldn't leave Dad alone, and Dad said he'd go talk to them. That was his way of not having to involve the park officials, because that's what Mom wanted. Dad didn't think it was the hippies. They seemed pretty nice, he said. But all the same, to shut Mom up, he'd go have a talk with them. And he did. And when he got back, Mom wasn't happy with him again. Apparently, Dad said the hippies had also been suffering nighttime raids like we had. They told Dad that one of them had seen it, and that it was a Sasquatch. Me, I had never heard such a word before. I was thinking it was a monster, and that it must have something to do with squash gourds. Now, I didn't like squash at all, and Mom was always trying to make some funky food out of it and make me eat it. So in my 8-year-old mind, I sure didn't like this monster right off the bat if it had anything to do with squashes. I know, the mind of a kid is weird, isn't it? So that night, uncomfortable though it was, we put that metal cooler with all the food we just bought again in the tent with us. And that was probably a mistake. Because that night, I woke up to something walking around outside. It was making heavy, deliberate, stomping noises. And if I had had any sense back then, I would have understood that there was more than one. But at that time, all we had with us was an old canvas tent, and it had been treated to be waterproof. While I don't know for certain, I would now guess that my parents had gotten it at an army surplus store or something like that, because the tent was an ugly jungle green color. And even with a fire left outside, the canvas was so thick you couldn't see much out there. Sometimes you'd get the etching or a hint of a shadow, but never a defined one. I mention this because the thin nylon tent that I have now, you can see shadows that are cast on the walls very well. They're very defined. If we had had a nylon tent back then and not that big thick canvas one, we might have seen what was really going on out there a bit better, and maybe things would have gone a little different for us. Also, the nylon tent that I have now has the bottom attached to it, as in it's all one piece and you just unfold the whole thing and tack it up. But the tent we had back then, it wasn't like that. The floor was separate, and you tacked it down separately and then to the sides. Now that night, Dad had deliberately left a small fire out front burning, and he set his little tiny alarm clock in the tent to wake him up every few hours, just so he could stoke that fire up a bit more throughout the night. His plan was that if it was a raccoon or a bear, it would probably stay away from the fire. But again, if we'd had a nylon tent with that kind of fire out there, things might have happened differently. Now I wake up because I'm hearing something, and so had my mom. She then shook my dad awake. There was something out there for sure walking around, and you could feel those footsteps more than hear them. It was out there. It was walking back and forth. I knew it was looking for the cooler, or for something anyway. There was all kinds of rackets out there, and you could hear the old aluminum chairs getting tossed around. You could hear things hitting the brush farther away from the camp. It was throwing things. I was scared. My dad had a pistol with him, and he had it out, and he yelled, "Get out of here! I have a gun!" It all went silent outside. We were listening for whoever it was to go away. Instead, we didn't hear footsteps walking away. We heard and felt the heavy footsteps through the earth come right up to the tent opening. It was dark out there, and it was darker in the tent. And I could almost feel, though, the look of confusion that must have passed between my parents. I know my mom was scared. And when the clear sound of sniffing at the tent opening started, I heard my dad barely whisper to us the word, "Bear." Now, this was not good. For the first time, I was really scared of a bear. If my parents were scared so bad that they couldn't hide their fear from me, that made me more scared than beyond words, though I didn't understand that at the time. Dad whispered for us to stay quiet, and I don't know if it was just me that was making a sound because I had started to cry, or if Mom was too. But when he said that, I quickly put my head down and covered my head with my arms. I started breathing in and out real heavy as I started to cry, right in to the material of my sleeping bag, hoping it would muffle the sound. My head was down, and that's how. I can't tell you exactly what happened next. Next thing I know, they're screaming, I'm screaming, and someone's grabbing me. And when I look up, the whole tent is gone. All I can see is night sky. And then I see something really big, this dark shape hunched over us. Now, when I think back on this moment, in my head it all happens like a film, and it's going on slow motion in my head. But I know that night everything happened as fast as lightning. So our tent's gone. I'm seeing the night sky, and there's something really big right in front of us. My mom's screaming. My dad starts firing the gun right at point blank at whatever it was. He got off two shots. Then the creature reached out and knocked him right upside the head. Me and Mom are still screaming, but we shut up because it leaned forward right at us and screamed right at us. When it stopped screaming, I only knew because all I could hear were my own ears ringing. When I screamed again, I couldn't even hear myself. But I knew it was really mad, and that is when I found out there was for sure more than one. Another big dark shape came from behind us and came up next to the other one. The one that Dad had shot was now crouched down right next to him, and it leaned down and let out another roar of rage. But Dad was knocked out cold. He didn't move. Me and Mom were too terrified to move. All I could see was from the fire that had almost gone out there. But I do know that it now turned its attention to us, and it looked at me and Mom and crouched in close to us. It sniffed the air all around us. It was about 2 feet from me, if that, but I could hear and I could feel those ugly breaths all around me. I was terrified. Mom was hugging me so tight, and she was trying to keep me from seeing, but I was seeing all right. I believed I was about to die. I just knew that thing was going to kill us. And for an 8-year-old to ever think such a thing, well, it says something about the moment that I was in. But it must have decided that me and Mom weren't a threat. But you knew it was still mad. Oh, yes, it was mad. It went over and it started kicking the living crap out of the picnic table out there. It threw everything it could find all around. The whole time, Mom was hugging me tight, and she was leaning around with one hand quietly trying to find the gun that had gotten knocked from Dad's hands, though I don't think it would have done any good. The whole time, it kept looking over at us. After what my mom said was probably a half hour of real time, of them just ripping up the entire campsite and from time to time coming close looking at us and screaming at us, they finally left us. It was close to dawn. Mom and I were both still shaking, but she managed to get the fire built up again. The whole time she'd been trying to rouse Dad, I kept thinking it was best to leave him laying still. She finally found the gun, and then, not long after, we were able to get Dad to wake up. With some help from us, we got him to the car. We got out of there. We went in and we got Dad checked in town, and they did say that he had a very severe concussion. We didn't go back to our campsite. We left everything else there. And as a family, we didn't go camping like that anymore. Now it's funny, I didn't fear the murderers from Southern California anymore. After that, those murderers down there, they were not the scariest thing that my 8-year-old brain could think of late at night. Oh no, I had met the scariest thing, and I knew it had a name. Mom and Dad would never say it, even when I asked them when I got older. They told me again and again that it was a bear that ripped up our tent that night and our whole campsite, and that it was a big bear paw that had reached out and knocked Daddy unconscious that night. I didn't believe it then, and I don't believe it now. Me and my husband have since spent many summers camping alone and with our children. We're now retired, and we spend 6 months of the year rolling around in a camper all over the United States and Canada. I've had bears stroll into my campsite late at night. I've walked right up on bears before, and they've walked right up on me. I've had them attack my coolers in a campsite. I've had them attack our camper. Yes, I do know bears, and I know what they're capable of. But I also know that what attacked our camp that night was never a bear. I know that it has a name, and I know that the hippies knew it, and they named it correctly. And that thing has a name, and it is Sasquatch. Thanks. You can call me Irene, or we can go way back in time, and you can call me what nobody but my parents ever called me, Reenie. Dear Buckeye Bigfoot, I live next to a wildlife reserve here in Ohio. I think I wouldn't like to say exactly where at this time, but I will say it is very interesting to say the least. It's been a wild time. I will start with my first encounter with something that still makes the goose pimples rise. It was my 6th birthday and my cousin's 9th. We share the same birthday. This was back in 1981 in the same village that I share my mailing address with here. We went to a nice restaurant and had dinner and a surprise party for us both. Man, was that embarrassing. I slid under the table and everyone laughed. My uncle had to literally pick me up and set me back in my chair. I still am not used to stuff like that. Later on that night, as we went to bed, I had some funny feeling to look out the bedroom window, which is on a hillside, next to the exterior door of the basement, which was old plywood. And there, looking straight in the window, was one giant, almond-shaped, glowing red eye. I was looking and wondering what it was, and then it blinked at me. And the other eye opened slowly, blinked two or three times, and it just stared in. I felt instant fear and started screaming like a little girl. My aunt and uncle came running in and asked what was wrong. I told them the devil was looking in the window. Uncle went out with a flashlight, and he looked around for a while and tried to reassure me there was nothing there. There was no way that was nothing. So later in the same year, sighting number two. We were farming people, so we were used to being out and about near the woods, animals, and the sort. Well, being at my uncle's on my dad's side, the adults were in the living room talking, and all the children were in the other room playing. We decided to play hide-and-seek, and of course, me being the bad kid, I went and hid behind the curtains in a room we weren't allowed to play in, my uncle's office. It was shortly after the harvest, and the moon was full. It was bright that night for sure. Why is it that when you get a bad feeling, the chills, you have to turn and you have to look and see why? Yeah, that's exactly what I did. Well, no, it was not the brightest thing to do. There in the field, walking away from the house, were not one but two giant figures walking away from the house. Close enough for me to tell the outline. The hair was long on the arms, the cone heads, and those devilish red eyes, glowing red eyes. Now, being religious, the first thing that came to my mind, demons. Oh, Lord, the one on the right turns at the hips, looking back from its left side. It turns back towards the one on the left, reaches out, smacks it on the arm like we do to get a friend's attention without making a big noise. Both of them stopped, turned at the hips, slightly turned their heads, looking back at me. Oh no, my shadow was cast into the field from the light in the house. Not knowing what to do, I slid to the right, getting away from the window as fast as I could. I ran into the living room and pushed myself under my father's arm, pulled it tight around me, and didn't want to move. He told me to go play. I said, nope, I am staying right here. And stay I did. We stayed the night since it was so late, and I didn't leave my dad's side until we left the next day. I never knew anything about cryptids then, but I know for a fact that Bigfoot is real. As I was sitting outside with a cigarette, typing this in, a whoop came from across the street, and then the coyotes started going crazy. I put out my smoke, and I calmly walked inside, closed and locked the front door, and then I flipped the switch to turn the floodlights on. Living here is interesting, to say the least. I've had three sightings here, just this spring and summer. My eldest sister thought one was a deer on the hill in the thicket, and I let her think it was a deer. I seen it too, from a little closer than she did. If you want to hear more, I can tell you what I've been seeing here. I listen to your videos as well as Cryptids Canada and Dixie Cryptid while I'm at work, and I know I am not alone in sightings in my neck of these woods. Keep doing what you do. It helps me. Thank you very much. I hope this isn't too long for my first email. Sincerely, Roger. P.S. You may use my name. I'm not scared of anyone teasing me. They always do, no matter what the situation. Hello, Nance. I am the guy that sent you the story about the little monkey that would watch me and Wendy play in the lilac bush that we thought of as our cabin. I promised I would write you about these things that we experienced after we moved back from Florida. I may need a little help from you to put this together as a story, because it's just a bunch of different occurrences and things that we would notice in the woods on our properties, and not really one flowing storyline. So you can feel free to use this as it's written, or take the information and edit it and put it together as you wish, or not use it at all. I know, it's not the most thrilling course of events. And just so you know, listening, I really haven't changed anything. I'm pretty much reading it straight as he sent it to me out of the email. The only thing I've done is I'll clarify that when he says he moved back from Florida, he means he moved to Pennsylvania. Moving on. We moved back from Florida when I was 15, so I had been gone for about 7 or 8 years. Wendy had moved away shortly after we moved to Florida, so she was no longer there when we came back. As soon as we got back, I took a walk up on the hill to check out my old stomping grounds and the lilac bush, or our cabin. It was still there, but it wasn't open in the center like it was. It had grown in, and the old bridge had fallen down. I became friends with a boy my age whose family owned the property that bordered my family's 40 or so acres. His house was roughly a little less than half mile up the road from mine. My dad bought me a dirt bike a month after we moved back to Pennsylvania, because I wasn't very happy with leaving Daytona Beach, Florida, to return to Walton's Mountain. My friend Jason also had a dirt bike. His property, my grandparents, and ours were all connected and ran up a valley a mile or so with a ridgeline behind everyone's houses. From the road that ran in front of our homes, it was roughly 2 to 2.5 miles back up over the hill and through the woods until you would get to another road. So there was a heck of a good-sized patch of unbroken forest behind us. One day, Jason and I were clearing trails for our dirt bikes. We heard a crashing coming through the woods towards us. We stopped and stood there, waiting to see what was coming our way. We were approximately 6 to 7 feet apart from each other. 2 deer came running off a hill and ran right in between us, and never even gave us a look. Something was chasing those deer. It had them scared enough that they paid us no mind. And they never even hesitated passing smack between 2 guys with axes. Now, mind you, this is before the internet and all the TV shows about Bigfoot, like that show Not Finding Bigfoot with that Matt Money Spanker guy. And I'm just going to add, guys, that's what he really wrote. Those are not my comments. Neither of us were wise to any of the things that now are known to be Bigfoot signs. And the monkey encounters with Wendy were a faded memory, so neither of us were thinking Bigfoot through any of what I'm going to describe in this story. It wasn't until years later that I would put all of this together to recognize it for what it was. Me and Jason's dads built us a really nice cabin out of sawmill slabs with a stone fireplace. It had a couch and 2 beds, a flagstone floor. It was way nicer than 2 15-year-old kids needed. Not that I thought that then, but I'm pretty sure our dads had a lot of fun building it for us, and they were like 2 big kids getting to play in the woods. Plus, my dad was still trying to make amends for moving me out of Daytona Beach and into the sticks. The end result? Was a cabin that was as nice as most people's camps. We would stay out there for days at a time, only coming home when we needed to resupply. 2 times, the front door of that cabin was wide open when we got there, and the doorknob, the part that slides in and out of the hole on the door frame, was damaged. It was like someone forced the door open without turning the knob. We just passed that off as someone trespassing and sticking their noses in our cabin. But why force the door open? Why not just turn the damn knob? There wasn't a lock. It would open right up. So we pounded about 100 framing spikes right through the door from the inside out, and that put a stop to that. We became quite familiar with the animals and the birds in the area and the different sounds they made. There was one sound in particular that we heard quite often that we had no idea what made it. It sounded like a drawn-out whoop without the W, like whoop. Also occasionally, we would hear what we thought was someone chopping wood or hammering something. Things would be heard bouncing off the outside walls and the roof of the place, which did make me think about that little monkey that pelted me and Wendy years earlier. But this time, it actually could have just been things falling out of the trees, although we did find a stone or two on the roof, here and there, and we never stopped to consider how stones would get on a roof. There was a medium-sized creek that ran up the hollow where our cabin was, and on at least two occasions, I can distinctly remember, we found stacked-up flat stones stacked about 14 to 18 inches high. I figured someone hunting stacked them to sit on, but number one, nobody should have been hunting on any of our properties without us knowing, and number two, who the heck would make their stool in the center of a creek? Me and Jason both had 22 rifles, and we would walk the woods hunting squirrel, or bunnies, or whatever else crossed our paths. On two separate occasions, I can remember walking for a mile or so and not seeing or hearing so much as a bird. Nothing, not even a chipmunk, and they were always scurrying around. I mean, dead silence. Nothing. Now, as I said before, this was a few years before the internet, and there wasn't really any TV shows on the subject of Bigfoot back then either, so we didn't know to look for trees broken off or stick structures. We never even thought of looking for tracks. There very well could have been a lot more evidence there. We just never added all these things up at that time to consider that it was all connected, much less that it was possible Bigfoot related. I mean, yeah, we recognized that some strange things were happening, but Bigfoot? I really wish I would have known then what I know now and have had a chance to really investigate that property from that perspective. All of my family's property was sold years ago, so I don't really have access to it anymore. I do think Jason's mom still lives there, but it's been decades since I've been out there. So either there's Bigfoot out there, or I'm just reading too much into a bunch of random occurrences. Guess I'll never know for sure. And yes, it bugs me. And oh yeah, for anyone who didn't catch my first story, this all happened in the northwest corner of Allegheny County, Pennsylvania. Hi, Nance. I was bird watching along Marble Creek in the Big Oaks National Wildlife Refuge in Indiana. It was May 22, 2016. It was a public use day for the refuge, so there were no hunters. I had never been to Big Oaks before, but another Audubon member that I know said they were doing wonderful things there with conservation and there were good birds to be seen. So I made my way. I was out there walking along the east bank of Marble Creek, just south of the split. The creek has a gentle arc in it, so the view fades out around several hundred feet up the creek. I was picking my way down there quietly, all the while listening for the birds, when I saw something. What I saw was way up ahead, and it was on the opposite bank, right at the end of where my visibility was going to fade out because of the arc of the creek. It was black and large, and it moved very fast. It had moved off into the brush so fast I couldn't get my glasses up to take a look. I still glassed that area, trying to find it moving in the brush, just to get an idea of what it was up there. I honestly told myself It was just someone else out there, and they were just dressed in baggy, dark clothing, because that's how brief the glimpse I caught was. And although it was late May and very warm, it wasn't unusual to see people dressed like that. I don't know why, but they do like to wear all black. Now, the glasses that I am using are Vortex Razor UHDs. These are not regular binoculars. They have good light-gathering capability, even at 1,000 yards. I can pick out feathers on a bird from that distance. But even with them, I saw nothing. I was a little confused, because while I thought it might have been a human dressed in dark clothing, what I saw, well, it just didn't have the feel of being human, and something bothered my brain. And I had that notion very strongly that it really wasn't a human, and that unsettled me even more, because I had been told there were no large predators in the refuge. I never go bird watching anywhere there is a known population of predators, because I'm almost always alone, and typically my gaze is focused upwards into the trees. The biggest thing that should have been out there should have been some deer, which are certainly not black and hairy, and deer don't move like that. So seeing something large and black set me back on my heels a bit. I waited several more minutes before continuing on. What I had seen was on the west bank, and I was standing on the east bank. So when I heard a woodpecker on my side of the bank, but further off in the brush, I moved out in that direction, away from the west bank, away from the creek, and eventually I was able to shrug it off. After a few minutes, I found the northern flicker. I spent some time observing him, and I was just preparing to move on when I heard something moving in the brush quite a distance away from me, and that's what really set my alarms up. What I heard, I could tell, was very distant from me. But I was hearing it clearly, so that meant that something making that noise had to be very large. Now, my vision was limited in some spots from where I was standing because of the brush all around me. But I did glass up and around through the trees at eye height. Most of the time, I still couldn't see anything. But at about 150 yards out, I hit on something black as I was panning and glassing around. Quickly, I panned back with the glasses, right around to the black. I found it right away, and that's when my heart stopped. Incredibly, in clear view, I was looking right at something that I never believed in. There's no doubt, I didn't guess it. It was a Bigfoot. I thought for sure this had to be some kind of joke. I mean, once before, a few years prior, I had ran into some kids that were making a little film project. One of them was dressed up in a big panda costume. And even at 100 yards, without my glasses, I could see that what they were doing, well, it was a costume. Though I thought from that distance it was a black and white cow. And with my glasses up, I could see it was a panda, and I could see clearly the bagginess of the costume. With that memory in mind, I thought, if I pulled back, I'd look around and I would see maybe some teenagers doubled over with laughter in the periphery, or maybe I'd catch sight of their little film crew. So I pulled the glasses away, and I scaped all around the bigger landscape with just my eyes. But I saw nothing. And then I glassed as far as the brush would let me, and I still saw nothing. Then I became concerned because at first I couldn't find that patch of black again. I couldn't find the Bigfoot, and I thought I had been imagining things or something. But then I panned back around, and I found him right where it had been. I saw it very clearly, Nance. I just want to say that. The fur was black. It wasn't a shiny fur, but it wasn't dirty either, and it wasn't tangled or snarled. It just lay flat on the body. The forehead sloped back, and the fur was very short on the skull, and then started to be a little longer around the face and on the face, and the fur covered all over the face along the cheeks, the jaws, and the chin and the lips. The brow protruded out over the eyes, and the eyes were a very dark, almost black in color. But I want to tell you there were no whites of the eyes that I could see, and it didn't seem at all like a set of human eyes. But the confusion for me was human eyes or not. Those eyes clearly had real intelligence in them. It's something that's very hard to describe, but if you've ever looked into animals' eyes, you know if they're intelligent, you know what they recognize. And I definitely was looking at a pair of very intelligent eyes. I saw them blink, and I saw the nostrils flare and then fold in very lightly every time it breathed in and out. It's something I couldn't have seen without my glasses, of course. And its mouth never opened, so I don't know about the teeth. I saw the chest of the creature, and I did not see any breasts, so I will say this was a male for certain. And it didn't seem to be much taller than me, but that could have been my perspective. I'm 5'6" tall. It could have been standing in a dip. I don't know about anything of the landscape over there. It could have been crouched down. I couldn't tell for the brush. But I will say that as it was standing, as far as I could see, it was between my height and maybe 6 feet tall, and I'm really guessing. Several times I took my glasses down, and I kept scanning all around with just my eyes. I was still looking for humans, a film crew, something, but I never saw anything. And I remember my heart began to pound fearfully because the next time that I put my glasses up to look at it, something had changed in its expression. Its stare was now definitely fixed right on me, and the look had changed from a look to a very hard stare. If I didn't know better, I would say it was pinching its brows together, but I don't think it was. But it did feel like it was, if you can understand. And what really frightened me was that I now heard other movement somewhere off to my west, toward the creek that I had just left. And when that noise sounded, I saw the Bigfoot's eyes flick over to that area for just a second. Then they came right back to me. I can't say that I'm one of those people who always has these amazing gut feelings in my life. I've really only ever had two. And when I have them, I have always been right. One of those two was a life or death situation when I worked at a bank and I got caught up in the middle of a storm robbery. My decision saved my life that day, and I went purely on gut. But that's a whole nother story. Right then, I had another gut feeling, stronger than anything I've ever had in my life. You put the other two that I've had together, and they weren't a third as strong as the gut feeling I had right then. It was so strong, it made the hair rise up all over my body, and my stomach twisted with a sickening dread. You see, I had the distinct feeling that there had to be more than one out there. And the reason that the one I was looking at hadn't moved all those minutes that I kept looking at it was because he was trying to keep my focus on him while another crept up on me. Now, what I had was a delayed reaction, but when the shock wore off, I was able to make my feet move, and I hightailed it out of there right away. I made it back to the creek by a different route through the brush, and I didn't care how much noise I made. The more, the better, I thought. I got to the creek, and I followed it out to where I had started from. I was still shaking some time later when I made it all the way back to my car. I sat there, trembling and crying uncontrollably, while other people were out there parking, getting in and out of their cars like they didn't have a care in the world, and a few of them looked at me like, "What on earth is wrong with you, lady?" But I couldn't speak. I didn't even try. Once I got myself together, I drove home. Now, since then, I've had a lot of time to think about this, and believe me, I think about this often, even 4 years later. I believe firmly that I was being hunted. I know animals do that, where one will keep your attention while others creep up on you. I know lionesses know how to set up an ambush point, and they know how to drive you into it. I don't know if it tried to follow me out of there or not when I started hightailing it. I never saw the second one, but I really do believe it wasn't far from me. And I am absolutely convinced I was being hunted. Now, I've been birdwatching for over 30 years of my life. I have been in all kinds of parks and refuge and wildlife areas all over the United States, Mexico, Canada. I've even been overseas, and I have never once been truly good and frightened in any forest or any park. But that day, I was terrified. I still am when I think about it, and I think it's a miracle I got out of there. Now, maybe I didn't get right up on that Bigfoot, but 150 yards away, from the look on its face, that was still too close for me. I can't be sure it would have killed me, but there was something in that hard stare that told me something bad was going to happen. And I didn't want to stick around and find out. I still go birdwatching, but I rarely go alone anymore. You can sign me Birdie. Nance, I once saw a Bigfoot at Serpent Mound in Ohio, but no one believes me. It was 2017, during July, and it was hot as Hades, like usual in Ohio. But me and my husband had guests in from North Carolina, and Serpent Mound was one of the things that they had mentioned that they would like to see. So off we went. If you've never been to Serpent Mound, it's about a quarter mile long, and it's a long, continuous earth mound in the shape of a snake. Everywhere I looked online, and the three books I have that mention it, all sort of disagree on who built it, when it was built, and what its purpose was. What we do know is it is truly ancient. I wish I knew some of those things for certain about when it was built or why, but even though I don't know, I have to say it's an incredible thing to see. They were all walking around, and now I should mention that they are our guests, which are my husband's now very elderly aunt and uncle, and my husband. Them being so elderly is why we also thought just walking Serpent Mound would be right at their speed. So those three stayed on the ground, but not me. I headed up into the big observation tower. From up there, you can see all around. And I'm not sure how tall the tower is, but from up there, you can just about see the whole snake on the ground. But all around the snake mound, there are lots of thick trees and brush. You should also know that Serpent Mound is actually on a big jutting out ledge of land, and as I recall from the map, there's a creek down below, though we never saw it. But up there on the ledge, there's area cleared all around the serpent itself, but along the edges, the trees have been let to grow nice and thick, which I actually enjoy. I remember standing there on the observation deck looking at it, and I thought, this is how it might have looked thousands of years ago when they built this. Of course, I don't know that, but I can't help but think it. So there I am on the observation tower, and I'm going to say, I know what I saw. No, I didn't have binoculars or even my camera out to zoom in on it. I had gone up the tower, and I had already taken the picture that his aunt requested. And then I put my phone back in my purse just to enjoy the view. I'm 52 years old, so I'm of the age where I don't live with my phone in my hand. But right out there, right along the side of the snake mound, on the right side, standing near where the line of trees falls back right where it had been real close to the walking path, I see something move. Now, I did a double take, and I'm squinting in the sunlight because it looked like a big tree had started to lean or move, but there was no wind. So I'm looking real close again, and then I realize, nope, that's not a tree. I see a creature, the color of the tree bark all around it, just standing there. I can't even try to give you a color. It was like tree bark camouflage, and nothing I think of to describe it sounds right. I will say again, it was very well camouflaged in the trees. If it hadn't moved, I would not have seen it. But it stood still again, and it blended in so well that the couple who came walking along the path walked within several feet of it. It never moved, and they never knew it was there. I think I was only able to see it right then because I was high up, and it had moved. It scared me so badly, I started yelling wildly. I don't know what I was yelling, but my husband and his aunt and uncle were all the way down by the mouth of the snake. I couldn't see them suddenly, and I could just a few moments before, and I wasn't sure why. Other people down on the ground are looking up at me. No one can understand me from up there. I'm just screaming all in a panic. But that creature that I believe was a Bigfoot, he heard me too, and he stepped backward suddenly, and then I couldn't see him anymore. I flew down those tower steps, and as I'm doing that, I suddenly remember my phone, and now I'm thinking, camera, I need to get a picture. But one of the park people there had heard me yelling and had quickly made it over to the bottom of the tower just as I made it down. I tried to tell him what I'd seen, but either I wasn't making any sense or, more likely, I was making sense, and he didn't want to hear it, and he sure didn't want anyone else to hear it either. I refused to walk down the length of the serpent to get to my husband, so the park person jogged down and got him for me. I don't know what they told my husband, but he came flying up there, of course. So I tell my husband everything, and I don't know if he has ever really believed me. I've been married to him for 29 years. We've raised children together, and we have multiple grandchildren. And he knows I don't lie or pull pranks. But I think that what I was telling him just stretched his belief and credibility of me just a tad too far, though he's never said so, and he's never told me that I'm crazy. But he can't say he's on board with me 100%. But here's the kicker, Nance. While we're all just standing there, and this is several minutes after I saw what I saw, I had started to calm down, and I was starting to feel rather foolish, and I started to second-guess myself, because everyone else was. I tried repeatedly to tell people, and repeatedly people told me I didn't know what I had seen. But right on cue, right then, there came this incredible roar like I don't even know how to describe. And that park guy, the one that told me I didn't know what I had seen and that I must be delirious or hallucinating, he about crapped his pretty park pants. Now, we're all looking at him, and everyone's asking him, what was that? I mean, he should know everything around there, right? But you could see he was shook up. And he truthfully looked at us and said that he didn't know. And then he began to urge us all to go back to the gift shop, and we'd talk about it there. Well, I didn't stay there and talk for long, but that ended our walk that day at Serpent Mound. Nance, I've lived in Ohio pretty much all of my life, and I always wanted to go to Serpent Mound, but never had. That was the one and only time I had ever gone to see the Great Serpent Mound. And I'm trying to get up the nerve to go back, because it really is incredible. Thanks a lot, Delia. This story is a little bit different. Now, you always hear how Bigfoot hates dogs and will kill them on sight, but this isn't that. Years ago, I was doing animal rescue with a particular group. Now, I don't want to say where or what group. I don't even want to say what area of the country, for a lot of obvious reasons, the least of which is we often resorted to trespassing in order to rescue dogs in dire situations when the authorities in that county or town refused to take action. At this time, we had been given good information that there was a large cluster of dogs in distress and they were staked out on a remote piece of property. Now, we were told they were staked up in the middle of the woods with no shelter, and that the man that lived there would sometimes remember to take them food and water, but more often than not, he didn't. Now, my first thought when I was told this information was that these dogs were probably going to be being used for illegal bedding activity. Turns out, that wasn't the case. I don't know what the man was doing. These weren't hunting dogs, and they sure weren't the kind you bet with. I don't really know. They were just all kinds of dogs. He wasn't being cruel to them, but he wasn't treating them as pets either. They weren't anywhere near his house. In fact, on his acreage, his house was another hill over from these dogs. We had gotten permission from the person who owned an adjoining piece of land to do some recon from there. One of our team members, I'll call him Bob, had climbed up one of the trees up the far hillside and used binoculars to check out the area. We do that to find out how many dogs there are, what the conditions they're in, and whether or not there's any other surveillance out there, which often happens with dogs they bet on. But we didn't see any of that. And even from way over there, we were hearing the occasional yipping and barking. I'm standing there below the tree, and I start to listen very carefully because I needed to gauge the level of distress those dogs were in. Because, really, after you do this kind of rescue work for a long while, it's like anything else. You begin to understand which yips and barks are from being alarmed, angry, excited, or if it's just the bored, desperate cry for help that I often hear. So I listened. But what I heard didn't sound at all like a desperate yip or bark. I didn't hear alarm or anger. It was a little more like excitement. About that time, I hear Bob up there. He's sort of cursing and mumbling, and he's scrambling around on different limbs trying to get a better look. "What's going on over there? What do you see, Bob?" I was yelling up to him, me and the other three rescuers that were waiting on the ground and looking up at him. We were all asking over and over. But Bob didn't answer. Instead, he climbed down the tree, and he had a dazed look in his eyes. Now, I have done many, many, many rescues, not just with Bob, but with the other people there. When you do this kind of work, you get very tight with people. And I knew him, and I had never seen him like this. He still wouldn't answer, and we kept asking him what was going on. I was thinking he had seen the man over there with the dogs, and perhaps he witnessed something really awful. I said, "Bob, what state are they in? How badly are they starved?" I kept asking different things to get him to talk. Finally, he said, "You ain't never gonna believe me." "What?" we all asked in unison. "I think there's a Bigfoot over there. It's just hanging out with the dogs." A couple of us laughed. What the heck was Bob playing at? We'd been on lots of rescues, like I said, and he had never gone squirrely before, no matter how bad the situation it was. "No, seriously," he said. "If that ain't a Bigfoot, it's a really big man in a costume over there with the dogs. And I mean big." Now, I looked at him in disbelief. I had always been a Bigfoot believer, truth be told, but I was not a knower. So I am intrigued at what he's saying, because like everyone, I knew that Bigfoot was supposed to be a dog hater and a dog killer. "What is it doing to the dogs?" I asked Bob. He looked at me. "Nothing. It's just playing and petting with them is what it looked like to me." Okay, now I am starting to call BS on him. I'm no young chicken, and I really couldn't tell you the last time that I climbed a tree. But with the help of a couple others, they helped push my fat fanny up, and that's just what I did. You couldn't see anything over there from the ground where we were because of the dip in the land where a creek ran through between the two properties. So there I go. I haul my rear up that tree with those binoculars. And sure enough, I saw exactly what he said he saw. Now, he said the Bigfoot was really big, but I rather think it really wasn't that big, judging its size next to the dogs. And I could see all the dogs, They were all staked out on various chains all around. There were no shelters or houses for them. Even in all my excitement, my training took over, and I tried to pick up details about the dogs we were sent to rescue. I saw food and water bowls overturned everywhere. But the dogs didn't look starved, and they weren't exactly healthy either. The Bigfoot, well, he wasn't pretty to look at either, but I didn't guess they would be, would they? He was a very dark brown, edging almost to black fur. He was very slender-looking from the waist down, but from the waist up, he spread out incredibly wide, and I could see muscles. I'd guess him 6.5 feet high. He really did look to be playing with the dogs. I held my breath in fear that he was just toying with them. But strangely, it seemed that the dogs weren't afraid of him at all, which I also didn't understand. Didn't Bigfoot and dogs have an immediate hate relationship? I mean, even if the Bigfoot was being nice, wouldn't instinct take over with the dogs? Wouldn't they fear him? I didn't know. Then, incredibly, I watched the Bigfoot pick up a stick and toss it in a light underhand motion with very little force. Two of the dogs that it landed near both went for it, yipping happily. And the one that got it trotted back over as close to the Bigfoot as he could and dropped it. Now, more than once, as I was watching, I saw the Bigfoot reach its arm out, and a big hand would pat up and down on one of the dogs. I don't mean like a human does it. It wasn't patted on the head or on the flanks or the side of the body, but right on top of its back like its spine. I saw a couple of dogs sort of squat and look a little worried when the hand was patting up and down on the spine. But as soon as it stopped, they went right back to wagging their tails. I almost fell out of the tree, I was in such shock. The whole time, everyone down below me, everyone but Bob, that is, was yelling up the same questions that I had just been yelling up to Bob. What is it? What's going on over there? What am I seeing? I looked down, and I made eye contact with one of the other women in the group who was right below me on that side of the tree. And I said, I see exactly what Bob said he saw. There was still a little light laughter from below, but it didn't sound as sure-sounding and confident now. I watched the Bigfoot through the binoculars again. I watched as the Bigfoot picked up one of the big metal bowls, and I held my breath as he started walking in our direction. I shushed the others below me. We were still probably 200 yards away, but I wanted them to be quiet. I didn't know what that Bigfoot was doing, where it was going, why, or what its intention was. So I watched silently as he walked down to the creek between the two properties, and he dipped the big bowl in the water and filled it up. He then returned to the dogs, and he set it down near an area where a few of the dogs could get to it. Then he rooted around till he found another one, and then he repeated the action, and then set it towards another set of dogs staked out further away. The whole time, I'm watching this like, no way, this is not happening. They set us up. This has to be a joke. We've been set up. That's what we all thought when I got down from the tree. And from the ground, we all saw it when it came to the creek for the water. And there was no denying what we were seeing. And although we all agreed that this had to be some kind of setup or joke, not one of us was willing to approach whoever that was out there that supposedly was pranking us. Because deep down we knew that was no costume. This was no prank. So, I thought, that's why the dogs were doing okay. The Bigfoot must be getting them water when the loser forgot to feed and water them. I wondered if the Bigfoot was feeding them too, and if so, what was he feeding them? I didn't know. We cut our recon short. We agreed we weren't going to tell the rest of the group what we had seen. But before we all came in to rescue those staked dogs, we would use those binoculars from the tree again to make sure the coast was clear. We did get all the dogs out a few days later. I'm sure the owner was mad. I heard about it. And when he finally figured it out, he raised a real ruckus, but nobody knew who took them. He was pretty sure who it was, and he was right, but he couldn't prove it. But it really wasn't him that I wondered about. I wondered about the Bigfoot. Was he sad that we took those dogs? I mean, what we saw, was that just a one-time thing? Had he just stumbled upon the dogs? Or had he been doing this for a long time, coming to visit with them and play with them? When we rescued those dogs, I wondered, did we perhaps take the only companions that Bigfoot had out there in those woods? Well, I guess I'll never know. Kayla.